And welcome to yet another glorious winter's afternoon out here in the African bush, and to be more specific, on Juma, Arethusa and Cheetah Plains game reserves in the Sabi Sand in the Greater Kruger National Park area of South Africa. My name is Jamie, I'm back on Rusty, and Dave is on camera with me this afternoon once again. And we're going to see what wonders we can find for you on your live safari this afternoon. James is out on bushwalk with Viam, again looking for all kinds of extraordinary things, some of the nicer, littler things that we often drive past. Not only are we live, but we're also interactive, which means if you have questions on anything related to, for example, these elephants in front of us, or any other aspect of African wildlife in general, you can send that through on hashtag Safari Live on Twitter, or you can email through to questions@wildearth.tv. And what a wonderful way to start off a very peaceful Tuesday afternoon. We started off actually with two young elephant bulls having a little bit of an argument earlier. It was almost immediately broken up by a very large female that came in and stepped in between them. And they clearly recognized her authority because both of them dashed off in opposite directions. And this little one has now decided that it makes much more sense not to incur the wrath of the female, but instead to munch on the buffalo thorn. Now we're probably about 200 meters or so, 200 odd yards away from the main camp, the DRC. We haven't had to go far at all on this afternoon's sunset safari to start off. And in fact, our walk down to the vehicle parking bays was accompanied by the gentle breaking of branches of this enormous elephant herd. There's lots and lots of them around, and I think they've probably just come from Galagopan. There's a little one hiding behind a fallen tree. And so many options for this afternoon. I think there's a chance we're going to go across to Cheetah Plains. I'm going to wait until Andrew and Ephraim go out and about on safari to hear whether or not quarantine is still there or if he has crossed. And if he is still there, then that's definitely on the cards for us. And that's exciting because, of course, as most of you know, I have yet to see quarantine, the male leopard that was the litter before the last litter of Karula's, who's now nearly 5 years old. Now that's something I'm really looking forward to. I still cannot believe in the year that I've been here, I have never seen him. Okie dokie, let's try and see if we can't reposition, since all of our elephants are now playing camera shy behind the trees. See if we can't get a nicer view. Now for those of you who were watching this morning's sunrise safari, we were out on bushwalk being followed by an elephant bull in must. And then unfortunately the bushwalk backpack went down, so we weren't able to sort of fill you in on how that situation ended. It was absolutely fine. We just made a point of retreating and not causing him, or ourselves I suppose, any distress. Hello boy. Can I come up next to you? Thank you. We'll stop here for now. I think if we go any further forward, then we're going to spook him a little bit, which we don't want to do. A young male at the age where he's now on the fringes of the herd. And enjoying a little bit of a snack. Beautifully warm afternoon compared to the morning. It's 22 degrees out here, which is 72 in Fahrenheit. Little bit of a breeze, but nothing major. This morning, of course, I nearly froze to death. Brian's lips and fingers were turning blue. It was very, very chilly. Hello, boy. It's okay. Ah, that's not terribly convenient. I suppose it's perfect for him. He gets a nice access to the buffalo thorn. But he's very much placed himself in a somewhat obscured view. And of course, if you missed the sunrise safari, I'm terribly sorry, because you would have missed out on the opportunity to see the wonderful Mr. James Hendry wearing the fluffy pom-pom beanie that he said he would after yesterday's ranger race if I won. I didn't, of course, win, but we were given the victory due to our amazing sighting with Shadow and her little cub, which is absolutely phenomenal. I really enjoy, even if it was a slightly shortly lived sighting, we really had an incredible moment with the little cub hissing at Mom when Mom went to try and enjoy some of what was her kill to start with. So at least we know that Shadow's young cub is not in any way lacking in attitude. Okay, right, I'm sure we can do better than this view. So while we try to do that, I think Mr. Hendry, speaking of him, would like to say a good afternoon to you all, mercifully free of the pom-pom beanie for now.
This little bush walk that we are going on today, here in the middle of the Kruger National Park, well, it infringes the VM doesn't think so. VM is on camera. My name is Jack. And he's just incredibly fresh leopard tracks. They're on top of the impala, they're on top of the elephants that you've just been tracking them. We're backtracking them because we think that they have gone. It's probably Karula. We heard distress calls of a warthog calling earlier today, just over to where Herbert's walked. And we think she's gone back on the tracks, maybe to fetch the cubs if she's killed something. If we don't find anything in the next little while, do is go back off the tracks. Be extremely fresh. I don't know. I mean, it's difficult to say. We had those fresh tracks we had the tracks this morning going down that direction. So maybe they're not quite as fresh as we think. But Herbert is convinced that they're pretty fresh. So come along. Certainly, we're going to be looking around for all sorts of things. Oh, sorry, our signal's not very good. Let's go back to Jamie. We're going to move into a better area.
Oh, dearie me. It seems as though James's bushwalk signal was disappearing ever so slightly. That's okay. We've managed to reposition to get a view of the large female that I spoke about earlier that was responsible for... Ooh, I nearly fell into the middle of the car. It was responsible for breaking up the elephant bullfight earlier. And I think she just did that so that she could come and feed at peace with her little calf that's behind her. Beautiful big elephant cow. Relatively long tusks for a female. You might catch glimpses of the secretion between her eye and her ear, around the temporal gland. And it looks as though they've been a little bit stressed out. All of the females have evidence of those secretions. And that could well be just due to increased harassment by a number of large bulls that have been around the area over the last few days. And they do cause a little bit of stress. I would say that the largest cause of elephant discontent out here is other elephants, particularly elephant bulls that tend to be a bit pushy when it comes to investigating the females, seeing if there's a chance to mate. Protecting her little calf. And if you look carefully, you'll see that there's actually lots and lots of elephants around. There's one up in the sort of top left-hand corner of your screen. Just a large grey shape in between the trees. Here we go. She's saying to Dave, why did you take the camera off me? I'm beautiful. I would like to be in the shot. There was a large tree in her way. She's made short work of moving it out of her way. And what she's actually doing is targeting the shoots and the grasses and so on that are underneath there, since it provides a perfectly sheltered spot. Essentially, there's just that little extra bit of nutrients under those dead trees that the elephants know how to utilize. There's little one. I saw, by the way, I watched the clip of James's baby elephant sighting yesterday. I don't think that there is much as marvellous as baby elephant, or as a curious baby elephant coming up to the car in the way that his did yesterday. They are just so terribly sweet. Obviously, I'm sitting watching this image through my monitor, and I have been struck by a question that I feel might have an immediately obvious answer, but I'm not entirely sure it does. There is a bottle of sweet, thick soy sauce in Rusty that I find most bemusing. Because, you know, every vehicle needs a bottle of Stafford's sweet, thick soy sauce.
It's highly flammable.
Okay, there we go. The answer from Dave. It's apparently highly flammable and is obviously used to start the fire for fireside chat yesterday. Aha, so we do have a reason, and it's not just that somebody suffered an enormous sodium craving at some point yesterday or perhaps this morning whilst James was driving Rusty. Okie dokie. Well, that explains that then. There you go, everybody. If you didn't know that already, apparently soy sauce is highly flammable. What on earth is in it that's so highly flammable? I think that may just have ruined my enjoyment of soy sauce forever after. As you can imagine, access to sushi out here is somewhat limited. We're a little bit far away from the ocean to want to risk the idea of raw fish. We appear to be blocking the way somewhat. Let's reposition. Okay, let me move out of the way of the builders that are trying to get through on the main access road. As I said, we're right next to the entrance to the camp. And while we do, and watching the elephants munch away, Debbie, welcome to the sunset safari. And you wanted to know a little bit more about how the foliage is holding up in the face of the drought and the dry season and midwinter. It's fine for now, Debbie. It's dry. There's no grass, really. The trees are going to be what essentially gets most of the animals through the coming months, since their root systems do have access to water below the surface of the ground, and there is still water left, but most of them have gone through their natural, those that are deciduous have gone through their natural loss of leaves at this point. All of the bush willows have gone brown and orange. Debbie, the time that's going to be really crucial and really difficult is going to be September, October. Because, of course, for us, the winter, the dry season extends right through until then. And if you combine that with the fact that we didn't really have much rain to start with this year, we've got ourselves a relatively tough situation ahead of us. Well, certainly the animals do. How does civil tons of elephant disappear? None of them appear to be terribly visible from this perspective. I don't see any. Do you see any, Dave? They were all around the entrance to our camp, and of course we're looking across to the entrance to the DRC. There's the new final control being built, and the wooden scaffolding around it that I'm not entirely sure what the purpose behind that is. It looks very secure. That is our main camp, everybody. And I think because our elephants are playing a little bit hard to get, I think we'll move on for now. I'm sure we're going to see plenty of elephants as we go along on the sunset safari. So we'll leave the slot for now and we will continue on. I want to make my way across to a place called Gowrie Cutline, where Herbert tells me, which is sort of what we had guessed, where Herbert tells me that there were tracks of little lion cubs playing in the sand yesterday when he went out on tracking team. And while we go off in search of wherever these wonderful lion cubs may be, fingers crossed, let's go over to James, who is on foot with some impala.
Well, there is the impala, also on foot, everybody. Sorry about you losing our signal there. As I was explaining to you, we're just fossicking around here to see if we can find any further tracks of Kurula, or whatever leopard it was that left those tracks, and whatever it was that caused the great screaming of a warthog in this area sometime during the middle of the day. I suspect, and so does Herbert, that it was indeed the leopard that's whose tracks we've just been backtracking. Anyway, that impala looks very, very chilled to the max, as they say. Let's see if we can get a little bit closer to him. And I've been seeing quite a few of these chaps on their own. So he's now looking at us. Oh, I wonder if he doesn't have a bit of a limp. Or is he just sort of getting rid of flies and things? But I've been seeing lots and lots of impala on their own. There's a nyala over there, Vimpy. And I don't know why that should be the case, and some of them have been lurking around with the kudu, some of them have been lurking around with waterbuck. You see the nyala? Okay. There's one nyala cow in this little bush, everyone. She's so brilliantly hidden. There she is, I can see her from here. And she knows we here, of course. There she is. You see her there in the shade, Vimpy? Is now moving off. You get her. Now, just to remind you, everyone, even though we're on foot, there's another one there, and they're going off. Just to remind you, everyone, we're just as live as Jamie is, so please ask us questions, talk to us while we're on foot. Hashtag Safari Live, questions at wildearth.tv. Ask us about the experience of being on foot in the wild. Well, you can ask us about anything, really, but largely about the experience of being on foot and the difference between doing things on foot like this as opposed to in the vehicle. It is a profoundly different experience, and it's a wonderful experience. HK, you want to know what the stick is for? The stick is largely a prop. It is used as a weapon every so often to bash the cameraman over the head. It's used to deter buffalo when they attack. You just clock them quietly, just behind the ear like that, and then they lie down. That's obviously absolute nonsense. It's basically just a prop to point with. You see, I look very authoritative when I'm pointing like this, displaying and saying things. It makes it sound like I'm talking the truth, you see, to have a stick like this. So that's why I have it. I think we're going to go that way. Just talking to Herbert. We're just trying to find if these tracks didn't pitch up again. Anyway, let's walk up through here. The last time we had Kurula in this area, of course, she'd killed a duiker, and it was on a tree just up there. Now, it's unlikely that she's done the same thing again, but it's not impossible. So what we'll do is walk through here, and first thing we'll do is just look at this lovely dung. Beautiful dung. Look at it, Viam. Isn't that lovely dung? Yes? And there's lovely dung all over the place here, everyone. And there's a herd of impala, obviously, that came through here. And I think it's probably, quite possibly, the same herd of impala that wandered off towards the Galago Pan. And it's on top of those tracks that we saw Kurula's tracks. So that's quite, well, a female leopard's tracks. I'm assuming it's Kurula because of where we are. Come along, Viam. On we go. We're going to walk this little game path over here and see if we don't come up with anything. Now, we are keeping very much aware, although I'm looking at you as much as I can. I'm trying to keep a 360 degree awareness all around me. Herbie's off in front. He's looking for tracks as well. And if we see something like a buffalo, I will obviously freeze, and I will tell Viam to freeze, and he will freeze, and then we'll assess the situation. Now, many people say to us, oh, but it must be so dangerous to be on foot, and it really isn't that dangerous on foot if you know what you're doing. And it's got to, I mean, we're trained, of course, to be on foot out here, but everything out here sees us as a predator, and so that's why it's relatively safe to be out here on foot. Okay, let's head back across to Jamie and find out where she is in her lion cub checking expedition.
I got distracted from my lion cub checking expedition just by the prospect of an active hyena den. So even though it was the wrong time of day, I figured since we're on the road, we might as well just check up and see whether our new mom with her new little babies is about. But as I said, definitely was a bit of a shot in the dark. It's a little bit too early for her to be at the den and for the cubs to be out and about. And as we sort of suspected, all was quiet at the Galago shortcut den for now. But I do know that this morning when I was on my way home, I heard one of the guides saying that she was there this morning, which is fantastic news. And another prospect for later this evening, depending on how things pan out. There's just so many options. I'm not entirely sure where we should go first. I think, however, the lure of quarantine is pushing me on towards Cheetah Plains, once we've checked for lion cubs, of course, because we're just that spoilt. There's a little dacre up ahead of us. It was right in the middle of the road. Let's try and... I'm going to say sneak up on it, but I think it's going to be gone. You see it there, Dave? Just moving along there. Oh! I think it might just have vanished. You got it. Tremendously shy little antelope. That's a leaf. Let's go forward a bit, see if we can't get another view of it. You gotta be quick with dacres, they have a tendency, you kind of have to get lucky, maybe is a better way of saying it. They don't, there we go. Hello. Here we go. Here's our little grey dacre. There's a small male. One of our monogamous little antelopes. Oh, here we go. Giving us a relatively good view for a dacre sighting. Most of them don't tend to stick around. As you can see, in terms of telling the difference between that and a steenbok, quite a straight back. They're very, very similar in size, those two different types of antelope. But a straight back, a slightly more grey colour, as the name grey dacre suggests, a grey or a common dacre. This is a little male, and there's most likely a little female somewhere around here. They've got tiny territories. Steenbok and dacre defend their little territories fiercely, the females against other females of the same species, and the males against other male species. Other males of the same species. Try and get that sentence to make a bit of sense. And hello to Ashley, who is in apparently a rainy and not so warm. Oh, actually, we've got another view of this dacre. Surprise, it's actually quite relaxed. There we go. Sorry, Ashley, I'll be with you in a moment. Let's chat about this dacre first, and then I'll answer the question that you have asked. Little mixed feeders. Combination of browsing, snuffling for shoots and roots and tubers, whatever it is they happen to find. And even recorded, especially with dacre, although all animals will do this, even the herbivores, the obligate herbivores, they will actually feed a nibble off carcasses occasionally. Boop! Gone. Oh, sorry, that was the top of my head. And he's gone. Wonderful. Lovely little dacre sighting. Sorry, Ashley, from your cold and not so warm or cold and rainy England, which sounds about right for my 3 years that I lived there. Which is the deadliest animal, be it large or small? So hands down, the animal that kills the most people in Africa. Would you believe it? The dacre is still there. What is going on? Poor Ashley will have to wait in suspense for the answer to her question. I can safely say, Ashley, that the deadliest animal is not the dacre. It is relatively tiny, and I certainly wouldn't want to corner one with those little dagger-like horns. But it's safe to say that the grey dacre or the common dacre is not the answer to Ashley's question. The animal that kills the most people by far, it's a sort of an interesting one. It's the mosquito, which was one of the options that you suggested in your list. And that's just due to its transmission of the plasmid malaria. And that kills more people in Africa than any other animal. If we go a little bit larger, the statistics seem to point to the hippopotamus being the next most deadly animal in Africa. It's up to you how you think of that. First of all, I think that the crocodiles probably claim more people than we realize. It's just because their bodies are often not found. They simply disappear. That perhaps they're not all deaths by a crocodile are recorded. But hippopotamus, well, they live in rivers. And people build their homes next to water. That's just how human beings work. We need water for day-to-day life. And so, of course, to the hippopotamus. And what happens is people go down to the river, they get between a hippopotamus and the water, and thus find themselves in tremendous danger. So the hippopotamus, in terms of the large mammal, is the one responsible for the most deaths. Now, from a deadly creature like the hippopotamus to a not-so-deadly feathered animal, let's see what evidence James has found.
Here's a nest, everybody, as is patently obvious by the fact that this is, in fact, a nest. We don't know what made it, though. Now, Steph found one very similar the other day and also didn't know what it was, and I really can't think. The only thing I can think of is something quite large, sort of bigger than a dove. It's not a dove, though, because doves put their nests up in the tops of trees, and they're often made of sticks. And so I don't really know what this is. Dove-sized... Yeah, it's really difficult to say. Green pigeon, perhaps? I don't know. It's not very high off the ground. It's only about probably 3.5 feet off the ground, so not very high. It's made almost entirely of grass, with a few leaves in it, but those may have fallen off the trees. And VM was just saying, imagine if he was an elephant or a giraffe, he'd have plucked this thing out of here and eaten it a long time ago. I reminded him, of course, that birds are full of parasites, and therefore it would taste probably very disgusting. There are, of course, those people who make soup out of the swift nests, but those swifts make their nests out of a foam. So it's a sort of a swift saliva soup, which I think sounds even worse than soaking this in water and drinking the proceeds. Anyway, that is a strange bird nest in a tree called Gymnosporia buxifolia, or the common spikethorn. And the common spikethorn here, of course, seems to be fairly untouched by browsers. There's a little bit of browsing that's happened on the top here. You can see where my stick is pointing. HK, you see how useful my stick is? And I don't really know what has eaten this, but I can tell you that down here there is a very definite browse line. Now, I think this is too low to be impala. I think this is probably dica that's eaten away at this tree. And the reason it maintains some greenery compared with many of its colleagues around it is that it is very rich in tannins. Many invertebrates have had a go at it. You can see they've eaten off the sides of the leaves like that. You see that, VMP? But there are lots of very nasty tannins and things in it, and I suspect that it's sort of late season forage for people. So, not for people. Yeah, it's really very rich in tannin. It's like really cheap red wine. You know, VM? VM is deeply excited. You can hear he's a... Let me just... this is what he did. He did this. It's not very nice at all. Anyway, that's this tree, and it hasn't grown big because the elephants have definitely... Maybe it's probably elephants that have had a little bit of a goad at the top there. It's interesting that it seems to be... Well, there's one that's been taken out, I suspect, by a giraffe there. Maybe the giraffe are coping with the tannins. Then just have a quick look over here. Here's another interesting thing. Can you see here, VMP? This particular branch here is green. Now, on some trees, they're very specially adapted in that the young branches photosynthesize for themselves, so they don't have to grow leaves. And that's very clever. While you're growing up and without having to produce leaves, you produce a stem that is able to photosynthesize. You see how green it is there? And likewise, these thorns will be able to photosynthesize as well. So that means while the tree is growing, it doesn't have to suck all the nutrients it needs, either from stores that it had as a seed or from the roots. It can actually still make nutrients despite the fact that it has no leaves. And I suppose that must help also in the wintertime. Now, the green thorn, or the torchwood tree, is a great example of something that has a photosynthesizing stem or thorn. And that is your tree biology lesson for the day. Right, let's carry on this way. Herbie is over here. Let's see if he's found anything else. I am, of course, extremely jealous because this morning, Herbie made Jamie a bracelet. He hasn't made me anything. I'm obviously chopped liver to him. Oh well, it's just the way it goes. And Jamie's bracelet is still on her. You must ask her about it. It's very pretty. I wanted a more manly one, of course. Celia, you are wondering about coming for a bushwalk in Africa and how fit you have to be. Well, it depends on what you want to do. So, I mean, all of the lodges around here offer what we call the 11 o'clock walk. In my opinion, the poorest possible experience you could ever have in the bush, especially in the middle of the summertime. It's not too bad at this time of the year. But that's normally just an hour-long stroll through the bush, and you look at the little things, the small things, and you experience looking at tracks and birds and trees and that sort of thing. A bit like what we're doing now, but without the tracking part of it. Celia, or you can do something like a Kruger Wilderness Trail or an Umfolozi Wilderness Trail. And what that is a full-blown trail. So you'll walk a few days and you can carry your own stuff. And then you do need a generally good level of fitness, but it's not, you see, you don't really hike through an area like this. It's all very much a case of, yes, you can spend hours on foot, but it's not so much a case of sort of going from one point to another, climbing up mountains and going over steep hills and valleys. It's very much a case of very careful walking, absorbing the atmosphere around you. And so you don't have to be massively fit at all, but you can't be totally sedentary at home. I think then you would struggle, but not for the 11 o'clock walk that you do at most of these lodges. NH native, no. The answer is no, mercifully not. People are not allowed to hike and camp in Kruger without guides. That would result in death for many people, and we don't really want that. It would do disastrous things for our tourism industry. You can, however, you can camp in Botswana without a guide. Well, I mean, you can camp in Kruger, but you can't go for a walk then. You camp within a fenced area. But you can't go for a walk. And there are places in Botswana and Zimbabwe though that you can pull into, and they have a campsite, but I mean there's no fence around the camp, so you can basically do what you like. And I mean they do lose one or two people every year, but that's mainly due to human stupidity. So it would be dangerous, NH native, for somebody to come into an area like this totally inexperienced to camp and then go for a walk, because if you didn't know how to react to an animal, if you didn't know how to interpret the bush around you, it really could be quite dangerous, especially with young kids. Here are some bones, Bimpy. Shall we try and identify them, or shall I embarrass myself by trying to identify them? Gracie, you say you will make me a bracelet because we are best friends. Indeed we are. And you say you don't think I'm liver. Thank you. I'm very glad you don't think I'm liver, Gracie. That's very kind of you. This, I believe, to be the heel bone of a buffalo. And the heel bone, of course, is on the... Well, you know where your heel bone is, of course. But on a buffalo, it's that much further up the leg. Same as a horse. It's on the hock. So that would be the hock there. That would be the sort of fused metatarsals that go down to the hoof over here, and this over here that VMP is basically sitting on is a hip, I think. Yeah, that's the hip bone. That would have joined there to the coccyx or to the pelvis, and this I believe would have joined onto the patella. No, it wouldn't. Yes. No, you see, this is where I get so horribly confused. That would have gone coccyx, hip. Yes, somewhere, something like that. That definitely went into the pelvis. One day I'm going to get this right, I promise you, everybody. I possibly should have been, should have studied something more veterinary in order to get a better idea of the anatomy of the animals out here. Okay, let's go across to Jamie. We're going down to fairly thick drainage line, so we'll try and keep a little bit quiet as we go. Let's go across to Jamie and find out what she has got to show you.
Well, I have an update for you in terms of what I have to tell you, and that is that there was a mating pair of lions on Gowrie Cutline, which is where we were going to be anyway, looking for a sign of that female and her cubs. Apparently the mating pair has returned to where we last saw them, which was on this road, and of course we had that incredible love triangle, sort of, just two nights ago, where we had the one Birmingham boy mating with Amber Eyes, and the new mother that has since moved her cubs onto Juma and is obviously lactating, and there was a little bit of hormonal, I described it as hormonal confusion, where the female then, the female in heat in estrus started mate, or attempting to mate, with the female that is lactating. Now I'm just concentrating, I'm just keeping a close eye on where we are and whether or not these lions are anywhere hidden in the shade. I mentioned it's quite a nice warm afternoon, and I think it's quite a good idea that we let James know about the possibility of mating lions. I know that he is in the area somewhere. That's not a mating lion, that is a log that I have spotted. There's somewhere along here. I doubt they would have gone. I'm not sure that's not a lion. Dave, could we please have a look? This is going to be very tricky. There's a fallen tree, and there is light shining on something behind the fallen tree. I'm going to attempt to pull out my binoculars, which did, of course. There you go. You see what I mean? Is that a lion? No. Is that a log? I'm uncertain. Any guesses, anybody? Doesn't that look like ears to you? No, that's a rock. Is that a rock? I think that's a rock. Oh, it's a tricky one. And of course my binoculars, very sadly, have broken somewhat. So the one eyepiece works, but not the other. I'm relatively certain that's a rock, but you can kind of, I mean, I'm not completely mad. You can sort of see what I mean. That looks like it could be a sleeping lion shining in the sun. No, that's a log, and in front of it is a rock. I think we have conclusively proved that. Oh well, it was a good attempt, but it's not a lion, very sadly. They're probably hiding in this big river system here. There's lots of shade and lots of cover. Now, this is ridiculous. I think I'm going to do another check on our lion rock log combination while we do that. It seems to be an afternoon for checking hyena dens. Let's see what's happening at the Mvubu Road one.
Well, I've come here to the Mvubu Road hyena den, everybody, or we, Vim and I, have come here, just to have a look. This is where the female was lying. And the reason we came here, well, we were walking past, and we came up here because it didn't seem like there was anything here, and hasn't been for a while. The big adult was at the Gallagher Shortcut Den this morning. I don't know if the cubs were there. And there are some tracks of cubs around here, but I don't think they're fresh, especially given the amount of leaves that have fallen into the entrance. But what I do want to show you here is how very, very deep it is. And I don't know if Vim is going to be able to show you. Can you get your... Have a look down there. Vim's handed me his torch. That's probably... What do you think, Vim? About... Unbelievable. Far in those little hyenas. We're just going to stand up again. 4 meters in. Which I think is absolutely unbelievable. And that's why no lion or leopard is ever going to go in there and shoot a hyena cub. I think that's magnificent. Anyway, then the other activity that's been around here since the hyenas have left, clearly some dwarf mongoose. We've got some dung of dwarf mongoose over here. Tiny little tracks, you can just see them. Now, if, let's pretend that we had come up here and the female had been here. What would have happened is that she would have skedaddled, she would have run away, she'd have stopped somewhere in the bush around here to watch what we wanted, and those little ones would have disappeared inside and we wouldn't have been able to see them. And I think that this tunnel goes all the way through to this side over here. And we've seen hyenas all over this den, and I'm just going to look down here and see if I can see anything further. And it goes all the way down to the right. I bet that it goes down and through the other side. And if I was a brave man, I'd probably try and crawl through myself. But I don't think I'm going to do that. There might be a snake in there and I could easily catch a disease. It's very tempting though. I'm probably slightly too large. You know, I'm a big man, Vim. Don't you think? Silence. You see, Vim is being very silent at the moment. You can tell he's about to go and leave. Here we are. So that's the hyena den on Bubu Road. And you can see what a clever place it is for them to be. And to put this back in VM's pouch. No, I'm not. I'm going to wait for us until we're offline again. Okay, let's carry on. What Herbert has done is that he's headed off towards the drainage there. And he's seeing if he can find some more leopard tracks. I also quite like the idea here of, I've always thought this was quite a nice place for the hyenas to be, especially in the evening. And it's nice to be actually at the den as opposed to observing it. And you can see the lovely light filtering through the Tambuti Grove. There's the trees that are all over this huge termite mound that I suspect has probably been here for hundreds and hundreds of years. Because these trees are not young, you know. These trees are very old, and they've grown out of this termite mound that has been here for many, many, many years. I think we grossly underestimate some of the ages of these termite mounds, because they do, you can see, there's been a huge amount of wash away and erosion, and then they get re-colonized sometimes, and they just get bigger again. But this thing is massive. I mean, it's probably almost half an acre in extent. Promed, you say, are those leaves at the hyena den? Yes, of course they're leaves. The leaves are coming off the trees now. Fleas. Oh, I haven't seen any fleas. There could be some. There'll definitely be some kind of parasites inside the den there. I haven't seen any fleas. There are some hairballs here that the hyenas have coughed up. This is definitely that Mum has eaten, and then she's come home and coughed these up while she's been here sitting at the entrance to the den. And you can see here, this is actually really interesting. I haven't found any fleas, but there is a bit of a whiff in the air. If you look here, you can see there's the hoof of whatever it was she ate. That looks like an impala hoof to me. And that hoof is indigestible. It's made of keratin, probably, and various other chemicals. Utterly indigestible. Same thing that a rhino horn is made of, pretty much. So if you are somebody who thinks rhino horn is going to help you with some kind of ailment, bear in mind it's utterly indigestible. And likewise hair, there you can see, totally indigestible even to a hyena. And the other thing that's indigestible, and you know what this was, it was a warthog, I think. No, it wasn't. I'm sure it was an impala. Is these thick bones. See these thick bones like this? They're indigestible to a hyena. And the other thing they're utterly indigestible to, of course, is a male lion. Now, would you all like to see a male lion? I'd like to see a male lion. So let's go and see a male lion.
Look at that. It's not a log. The other one was a log, but this is not a log. This is a male lion in all his glory. And looking a little bit like he is missing somebody. I wonder where that female disappeared off to. But she has managed to escape his attention for now. And he is busy giving himself a jolly good foot clean. Somebody, of course, is desperately trying to get hold of me on the Game Drive channel. Every time they try, somebody else starts talking. You're welcome to make your way to the sighting. Sorry, I was trying to respond. Isn't he absolutely glorious? Right, let's reposition so we can get a view of his face. And it also gives me an opportunity to just have a look at the tracks in the road. I think this female has ditched him to try and make her way into the drainage line to join the other female. And there's lots of happiness on the Game Drive channel because they have found Cheetah. Unfortunately, they have found Cheetah on Buffle's Hook, which is most unfortunate for us, but lovely for them. Here we go, tracks everywhere. Looks like just tracks of the male when he popped out of this drainage line. There we go. Just wanted to have a nice look, see if I can't get an idea as to where the female went. But if he's come through from here, chances are she is somewhere in here, maybe hiding out in the shade. But I suspect more strongly that she's in there with the female and the little cubs. Ah, but if we could go and have a look. It's so thick in there. Okay. All right, boy, let's get another view and make some space for the other vehicle that is coming to join us. Got a face full of hair, or a mouth full of hair, that he's busy trying to get rid of. And I am thrilled to hear from the mystic boy, for whom this is a first time experience here on safari, and saying that he is in absolute heaven. Well, I am thrilled to hear it. I am in heaven too. There's nothing better than starting off your afternoon with a magnificent male lion. And Mystic Boy, we actually have some extraordinary tales to tell you. The wonderful thing about Safari Live is that it becomes something of an addiction. And I'm going to tell you a little bit of a background to this lion in a moment. I'm just going to wave hello to Taxon and his passengers. All right, and off they go. They seem to be in a hurry since they can go and visit the cheetah. That's, I think, where they're going to be racing off to. Now, the Mystic Boy, a little bit of history for you and any new viewers who have not yet encountered the Birmingham Boys, for this is one of the Birmingham Boys. This is Blondie, I think. As far as I know, I need to do just a quick double check there because I haven't looked properly at him just yet. There's four of them. No, it is Blondie. It's definitely Blondie. There's the little cut under his eye that was inflicted, I think, by one of the females. Now, the Mystic Boy, a year ago, this young male looked absolutely pristine. He did not have a single scratch or scar upon him, and that was because he was young and had not yet established himself as one of the dominant males of the area. He came in with four coalition mates. The Birmingham Boys numbered five in total, and they actually took over this area as their territory just 1 year ago in truly spectacular style. Oh, yes. It would have been such an exhausting day. Luckily, you've got that pillowy mane to help to rest your head upon. Actually, Blondie's looking really good. He's all fulled out. His mane is totally fulled out, starting to extend down to the center of his chest. What are you doing? Oh, just what a day. It's a tough life being a male lion, especially when every time you mate with a female, she gives you a smack. It's So he's looking as exhausted as he is, first of all, because that is what lions do. And secondly, because he has been mating with a lioness for probably the last 5 or so days. I'm actually surprised that he's let her out of his sight, which means I keep double checking the patches of shade around me in case she is here. But it could be that we've encountered them just as we separate, or just as they separated. And the mystic boy, whenever you choose to come on safari, there is no particular best time in terms of encountering lions mating. And that's because, no, they don't have a set breeding season. They can go into estrus at pretty much any time of the year. What usually happens with pride, so what you have is, we always think of a pride, or at least the traditional view of a pride, is that... Sorry guys, I have to speak very softly, so I'm just going to fiddle with that for a moment, because otherwise you're not going to hear a thing I say. I think she's gone in there. Sorry everybody. Yeah. I think the other female from Torchwood is in there as well, with the cubs. There we go. Big rollover. Sorry, Mystic Boy. Just saying hello to the other vehicle that's come to join us. So we tend to think of prides as one male with a group of females. That's not actually how lions work. The prides are solely made up of females and their offspring. They hold a territory. And then you get a male or a group of males. Oh, he just gave such a huge sigh there. A group of males known as a coalition. And they have a territory that will be dominant over a couple of different prides. So there's no set breeding season, although what will often happen is that the females will try and time their estrus cycles, or the time that they breed, with each other, or sort of close together, so that when they do have their cubs, they are of a similar age. And that means that the whole pride is invested in looking after the offspring. And doesn't he just look absolutely exhausted? Well, he's been mating once about 3 or 4 times an hour for the last few days. I think he deserves a little bit of time off. We had the most extraordinary experience with him, I think it was 2 nights ago, where he was mating with a female. He then proceeded to play, hide and go seek with each other, using my vehicle as the in-between hiding spot. Okay guys, I'm going to give up my best seat in the house for a moment, let the other vehicle come and have a look at his glorious head, since at the moment they've been presented with a less glorious view of his bottom. While we do that, let's go over to James, find out how his walk's going.
I'm in a tree, everybody, but the tree is an interesting tree. It's called a sneezewood tree, and it's in the banks of this great drainage line. Now, many of you have heard me speak of the 4 drainages that feed the Gowrie Dam. This is one of them. They all end up as tributaries to the great Mulwati drainage, the banks upon which that lion is sitting right now, or sleeping and doing nothing, which is what lions do. Now, through here, you can see some of the geology of this area. You can see very sandy, very sedimentary. Some of it's sedimentary, but some of it's just very ancient granite that is already, that is in a process of advanced decay or weathering, if you like. Now, granite is igneous, which means it comes up as a volcanic sort of it comes up as lava, and then it solidifies into what we call, what is granite. And if you look around here, you can see the different colors, and there are lots and lots of different kinds of minerals and things that exist in the soil here and in these rocks. I'll tell you what they all are, and I've always found geology slightly snoozeworthy, but Steph is a geologist by trade, and he might be able to tell you some of the more complicated minerals here, but it's largely silica that's quartz, basically, and that's what mainly makes up this granitic sort of that these drainages, there's no ways that they could have remained as they are here, you know, flowing once every, I don't know, flowing once every 10 years or so for half a day. They couldn't have created these amazingly beautiful sort of fissures through the earth unless they flowed for much longer. And the only way they would have flowed for much longer, because the catchment for them is very small, the only way they would have flowed for much longer is if there'd been a lot more rain at some stage. So thousands of years ago, I suspect there were probably, I estimate that the rainfall here was probably at least three or four times what it is now, which I think is quite interesting. It must have eaten away these beautiful drainage lines that are now dry. And they dot all over the lowveld. They crisscross all over the lowveld, feeding the major rivers, which are sometimes perennial, but largely they're annual. And this tree is called a sneezewood because the plant has got, well, it's got a very sort of distinctive smell about it. And I don't know, Steph pointed this out to me. I don't know if you've seen where you're from. Sort of tasting
It seems as though James's signal was breaking up a little bit there. Guys, I know we've just found him and we are going to come back to him, but we gotta go. And I'll explain to you in a moment. I'm just waiting for the other vehicle to come past and move on. But there are, Steph's just called us to let us know that there are alarm calls at the dam. This morning we were following alarm calls. Let me just wait for the car to move away from him so we don't disturb him. One engine on at a time. Okay, there we go. Bye-bye, boy. We'll be back, I promise. Sorry, everybody. I know you're very, very excited to see a male lion, but he's not going anywhere anytime soon, and whatever's making alarm call or whatever's causing the alarm calls at the pan might not be there for too much longer. So we had kudu alarm calls, that's why we were in the area that we were in. Let's just look for the lioness at the same time. There's too much to do. let's keep an eye out for her. I'm convinced she's come back here and she's brought him with her because she wants to go and join that lioness with the cubs, and I'm convinced that they're in here somewhere. But that is a topic for a different conversation. It's Ferrari Safari, our way to the dam, because Herbert reported hearing distress calls around the dam itself. The dam cam is down from final control side, and I'm sure that Tingana, because Herbert found big male leopard tracks, I'm sure he was responsible for the alarm calls that we were hearing this morning, and they could well be responsible for the alarm calls now. And there's no time to delay. But we must look for the lioness at the same time, because it could also be her. So, you know, juggling several balls in the air at the same time for now. Hello, Impala, you look very relaxed. You don't look like there's any lions chasing you, or leopards. David clinging on for dear life. What do you say, Dave? Am I better or worse than the other two in terms of throwing you around? Okay, it's all equal. Fair enough. The poor cameraman put up with so much from our side. Okay, let's slow down a bit here. Something's moving. Let's just investigate. The buffalo at the pan are looking relatively calm. And Steph said it sounded like the alarm calls were coming from the northern side of the dam, towards where the old buffalo carcass is. I'm not seeing any tracks, but that doesn't really... Oh, there's the impala that we're probably calling. They're looking in the direction of the pan itself. could be absolutely anything. Could be a lioness. I'm not sure what was alarm calling. I just know Steph heard alarm calls. But everybody's looking relatively calm. Might have been a little bit closer towards Gallego Pan. There have been alarm calls on and off here all day. There's a kudu and a kudu calf. Let's just see where their attention is focused. Well, it's focused on us for now. No, it's too little, too young kudu. Where are your mums? What's happened to your mums? Why are you all alone? There's kudu at the other side of the dam as well, drinking, looking very relaxed. So let's just sit and listen for a moment. Kudu calves walking straight towards a very thick area. Those kudu looking perfectly relaxed. Let's just go investigate a bit further. Maybe we'll get some tracks that will give us a better indication as to what is happening here. The impala look very relaxed. They don't look concerned in any way. Now I wonder what on earth has got everybody so stressed out. They seem fine. Let's go a little bit further towards Gallego Pan. There might be something on a mission there. All that excitement, there's got to be something here somewhere. Alright everybody, keep your eyes peeled. The leopards love this drainage line system. In here. Of course, could be Mvula, Tingana, the lioness. I don't see any tracks though, that's the only difficulty. Oh, oopsie. Might have been a little bit more in this direction. Now, Steph, of course, has the most incredible ears. He is so good at hearing alarm calls and listening for the various sounds of the bush. And we did hear reports that there was even a distress call this morning from inside this block or around the lodge. I don't see a single footprint. All right, everybody, hold on. This is the bumpy patch. From a time where we had water on this reserve, the road has ended up being incredibly bumpy, churned up by the elephants playing in the mud there many, many months ago. This is a mystery. Yesterday, of course, on our way home from Fireside Chat, we had Karula wandering around Final Control. And then this morning with all of the alarm calls, it seems to point towards the possibility of at least one leopard hiding up somewhere around here. Okay, let's try double-check Galago Pan. Somebody has driven past there at some point. Their vehicle tracks are here. But everybody's gone rushing off to the cheetah. And just by the way, it sounds as though quarantine might have gone south towards, or south into Mala Mala. There's an update that came through from Ephraim. So once again, quarantine, the male leopard has dodged me. Everything looks far too calm. Not a single animal here that looks on alert or stressed. I can't see any monkeys. Monkeys are usually one of the best indicators that something is up. And all of the animals looking perfectly relaxed. So if there was a predator moving through here, it was a predator that must have been on the move. Here's James's tracks from where they walked past Galago Pan. That's an Inyala. A very relaxed looking Inyala, although perhaps because he thinks, or he knows, he has the safety of the lodge fence. Which is not, of course, a guarantee of any kind of safety. A leopard could jump over that in a heartbeat, and Karula famous for at one point hiding her cubs underneath the deck of one of the guest rooms. So the Inyala, hidden behind the fence there. Everything just seems terribly relaxed. And of course, Steph can't talk to me directly to tell me where exactly he heard those alarm calls from. Dave and I are going to investigate Galago Pan, see if there's not something drinking there. While we do, let's go across to James for an update.
We're just not far from where Jamie's sitting right now. And there's a sense of expectation around here. We came back to... I mean, you heard those alarm calls that Jamie was hearing. She's just over there. The Galago Pan is there. The Juma Dam is over there. When you first saw us, we had the tracks around the Galago Pan into this area here. Herbert is just down there, just following down through the drainage, and there's a real sense of expectation around the place. There's a sort of, there's a silence, almost like everything out here has seen something that we're looking for. Wind is perfect for us. Can you see that, Vim? So whatever is over, if there is something over there, the wind is perfect. If there's something behind us, of course, it will have smelt us some time ago. But we've come from that direction all the way along this drainage. So I don't know. But Herbert is walking much more slowly now, which indicates that his kind of bush sixth sense is such that he thinks something's around here. The road that Jamie's on is just above there. In fact, you can see her moving there. There she is. Let's see if she spots us down here. I'm sure she will. She's just checking around the Galago Pan. But there really is a sense of something. I don't think she spotted us. Ha ha ha. Alright, let's go and try and catch up with Herbie. What we'll do is walk up here. Herbert is down in the drainage. I think we're going to loop if we go there. So we're going to walk up this way. We're just going to keep looking at the ground, seeing if we can find any leopard or lion tracks. Plenty of female lion tracks in there. Remember, we've talked about the fact that we think maybe the Nkuhumas have been in there giving birth. No cub tracks in there, but plenty of female lion activity crisscrossing this drainage system. But I can't say I held out a great deal of hope here, because I think we would have found something by now. What those impala were shouting at is anyone's guess. Let's just walk back sort of to where we began our little jaunt this morning and see if maybe the tracks have come back. Maybe she has brought something. Could have even been a hyena, you know. Easily a hyena could come past some impala, come down for drink. They'll make a little alarm call, get very upset. Just have a listen, everybody. Let's keep listening out for things. Thomas, you want to know on Pennsylvania if we teach people how to track on a walk. Thomas, we don't generally teach people how to track. I'm just climbing a tree specifically for Jamie because she thinks I fall out of them all the time. This will probably result in my doing myself a severe injury. Do you see I'm in the tree? I see I haven't fallen out yet. Yes, yet. Viam, there's a nyala over there I've just spotted from my perch up here, like a baboon. Jamie, where do you think the alarm calls were coming from? And what do you think caused them? So Jamie says she doesn't know what was alarm calling and she doesn't know where it was. So it's all rather perplexing, to be honest, everyone. And Steph did go and have a look and he hasn't found anything, so who knows. The Nyala are looking very, as they say in, you know, local young parlance, young bucks like Jamie use terms like this, chilled to the max, running through the drainage line over here, and they look fine. It's deeply frustrating. Absolutely. There was just a bit of silence, I felt, you know, that kind of silent expectation, but that may well have been totally sort of psychological. JJ, you want to know if it could have been a snake that they were alarm calling at? No, I don't think impala would alarm at a snake unless it was in some thick bush and it was a very large python and it was about to chew one of their little babies. And sometimes very big African rock pythons will attack young baby impala, but it's unusual. And I don't know that they would have made a big noise about that. There's some birds alarm calling across there. All right, let's go back across to Jamie, who's not far from us here, and get her take on things.
The hilarious thing about that particular link was Kirsty, of course, said that she had asked James to hop across to our vehicle and then sort of stopped herself and went, not physically. That might be a bit of a stretch. Okay, thanks, guys. We're going to go back, I think. Good. I think we are going to go. Well, we found a lion.
Yes,
we're going to go back, I think, to our lion for now.
All right. We'll have another squiz through here and then give it up.
Okay. Perfect. Okay. Yeah. We'll keep a close eye as we go around. As you were. I kind of wanted to see the descent, though. In case there's a mishap. Bravo. Oh, beautiful. Nailed the landing. Right. I concede.
7 out of 10 I got from Kirsten. On you go.
I'll give you an 8, James. Bye bye. Well, that was a bizarre encounter. Moving on. Sticulars are a little bit unhappy in here. But the Nyala are there and they're absolutely fine. I mean, you can barely see them, but there are Nyala there. Do you see them there, Dave?
Yeah.
You do, thank you. So there are some Nyala hiding at this point, I think probably from the very strange primate that they just spotted climbing a tree and glancing over in their direction. Not at any kind, not seemingly concerned about any kind of predator. Right, let's carry on. A really good question coming through from Monique in London. Monique since we were busy looking for watching the behaviour of the other animals, and James pointed out the expectant silence, but everything seems perfectly content and relaxed. So Monique's just thinking about how long it might take for the animals of an area to relax if an animal catches one of them. And actually, truth be told, they relax very quickly, because obviously at that point, chances are the threat is over. They're not going to get too close. But you'll even find that animals, when they can see a predator, even if it hasn't caught anything, if it's not showing any signs of predatory behavior, if it's not stalking, or if it's just lying down flopped in the sun, those animals actually can be quite content to give it a little bit of a wider berth, but still stay within the vicinity, because of course it's not the lion or the leopard you see that catches you. It's the one that's hidden away. And very often if they see that the, let's say, with buffalo, if they see that the lions have caught a member of their kind, all right, buffalo are a little bit different, they might come back and try and help out the stricken member of the herd. But the animals do tend to relax relatively quickly. I feel like I'm going completely balmy. Like I've been following alarm calls all day. It always happens around this Galago shortcut area, or the Galago Lodge, Wuertela Lodge, because it's made up of some of the densest vegetation in this reserve, combined with a number of different interlocking river systems that makes spotting and finding something, unless you bump right into it, somewhat of a tricky practice. But a really good question, Monique, and the answer is they relax relatively quickly. In fact, there is a fabulous Billy Connolly sketch, the same one that Brent's often spoken about, which I showed him, by the way, about the lioness hunting the wildebeest, and then the fact that once they have caught the wildebeest, the other wildebeest stand and stare at whatever's going on. You can have a look if you want to. Have a Google of Billy Connolly and the wildebeest. Please do not do so if you are offended by in any kind of strong language. He is Scottish, after all. So if you're offended by strong language, don't Google that. If you're not and you'd like a bit of a giggle, Billy Connolly and the wildebeest. Have a look. He's got some comments to make about the fact that the animals hang around after one of their kind has been hunted. And indeed, whether or not wildebeest know that they are wildebeest, or if they think that they are zebra or vultures or anything that they see, since there's no, as he describes it, no mirrors in the savannah. And he's absolutely right. I've almost forgotten what I look like at this point. Whoops. There's nothing here. There's no tracks. I'm listening with half an ear and about an eighth of my brain to the Game Drive channel and the updates there, and I mentioned that the cheetah are on Buffelsoek. They're on Buffelsoek Kruger National Park boundary. So for James Richard, and I'm sure many of the others wondering about this, it does seem as though it is our usual pair, the two males that we often see on Cheetah Plains. They go all the way north from Cheetah Plains right up into Manuleti. So through Torchwood, through Buffelsoek, and out the other side into Manuleti. It does seem as though it is them, but James, you are absolutely correct. It would be lovely to see a female cheetah. I have yet to see a female cheetah since I started working here. Oh, gracious, that's an inyala. He's very, very hidden in the gwari bushes. Is that the car or an alarm call? It was an alarm call. No, that's an alarm call. Where are they looking? Where are they looking? What, Impala? Okay, guys, we're getting closer. Just keep your eyes peeled. Not in this drainage line. Where are they looking? Oh, they're barely looking. They don't look concerned at all. Half-hearted barking. What? And then half of them have gone back to feeding. I really hope we don't just have a group of Impala that cried leopard, which is like the boy that cried wolf. They're looking, they're looking straight into this terrible block. And that's, I can almost guarantee where our leopard is. We're going to give it a try, folks. We are going to give it a try. It's the block where Mbula, on our spectacular Father's Day weekend TV specials, chased away the hyena and then promptly got chased back. It is an absolute nightmare of a block. Oh, now I've got to do this patch of road in reverse. Everybody hold on. They're looking straight in here on the opposite side of the drainage system. A bit for Jamie. Herbert, Herbert. I think Herbert's turned down his radio to listen. Okay guys, let's keep our eyes peeled. These impala, I don't think it's a false alarm, but I think it's quite half-hearted because, just like we were talking about with Monique's answer to Monique's question, I don't think this predator is displaying predatory behavior. I think it's just walking. But they're alarm calling off in this direction. Now, there's definitely something here. Got it? Sorry, we've got to go backwards or else we're going to smack the VR rig. Yes, I know Impala, but where? Okay. Let's keep our eyes peeled, everybody. I'm looking. They're still calling. All right. They're still. Oh! Boons now upsets the stickler's alarm calling everywhere. Where is this creature? Are we on the right side of the drainage line? Now I'm just trying to communicate to Herbert that I found the alarm calling impala. They're still alarm calling. The stickler's are furious. That's the rattling sounds we hear. Where? Where? So close. There is something here. Unless they got a fright because of the baboons that we just heard, because that didn't sound like a baboon alarm call. In fact, those baboons are not alarm calling at all. And now the impala and everything have all gone quiet. Let's go forward a little bit. I'm not going to continue into the block where it gets thick. There are off-road tracks here, so we're basically following a two-track. Everybody keep your eyes peeled. There's something here. It's just a question of what it may be. That baboon screech worries me a little bit, because I've had impala alarm calling at baboons before. Okie-dokie. I'm going to go for a little bit of a walk, not far, but just down to the drainage line while I do that. Let's go back to James, who is also on foot.
There's a buffalo, everybody, at the pan, a long way away from where we're sitting, probably about 150 meters. Herbert is just off to the left-hand side of your picture. He's listening for the impala. Jamie's also just off to the left there. And then to your right-hand side, there is a very large jackalberry tree in which we've seen leopards before. And what we're just going to do while Herbert assesses the situation over there, let's just go around here and see carefully if there isn't something hanging out of the tree. As if there's a warthog or something like that that was murdered in this region sometime this afternoon. It's highly likely if Karula was the killer that it could be up in a tree like that. I wonder if Jamie's not hearing Impala alarming at lions. There were some lion tracks around here earlier, and it makes sense to me that there should be lions in that area. Let's go, let's get an assessment from Herbie. We haven't found any further tracks around here, so it's really difficult to say what's going on, but there's a nice view of the buff over there. And we'll just have a quick look at them. They're completely chilled to the max, as they say, CTM. I don't think that's an official acronym. Donna, you say, have I ever been on a walk and unexpectedly come across something that scared me? Donna, many times. This is why I'm walking as carefully as possible. Buffalo, mainly, that was fast asleep behind a bush. And then they stand up and say, well, the answer, of course, is inescapable. No, I didn't. I'm so retreat. But normally, I mean, plenty of times. And, you know, just now, just before you came to us, we were standing, looking around, hearing the power alarm calling, whispering away, and a scrub hare exploded out of the bush and charging through there. Yes, so many things have scared me out here, Donna, and Franklins are the worst. Franklins wait until you nearly stand on them. I see Jamie's vehicle up again. We might have to have a brief conference with her. And Tim, yes, absolutely. You say, do the lions see us as a predator? Yes, they do. The vampires don't, and that's why I'm carrying this thing here. This is to drive into the heart of a vampire if I see one. But the lions absolutely see us as predators. And so, they look, you've got to be careful. You don't want to walk too far close to them. They'd normally stand up and growl at you. And then if you walk away, they'll leave you alone. Sometimes they run away, but they definitely see us as predators. What do you think? That's what I think it is. Yeah. Okay. Yeah, you go and see if she pops out the other side there, maybe. Okay. So, Jamie's reckons, and she'll tell you this just now, that the lioness might be going back towards the male. And I think that's quite a good theory. Yeah, yeah. It's so confusing, everyone, even though it's such a small area. Bye-bye. Bye. Look what you got so. Okay. Let's follow. We'll follow straight across here. With any luck, we'll come up with something else. Okay. All right. So Jamie said that the Impala were calling inside the block here, quite far in. So let's walk a little bit faster. I am, of course, being utterly facetious about the vampires, I hope you realise. Question from Howard the Duck. Howard the Duck, you want to know if there are any vultures out here? I can't see any at the moment. There are plenty around. But we have, sorry, VM. VM just walked into a tree, everyone. He's not used to being 7 feet tall. How the duck? Vultures have copped it badly over the last little while. I think, you know, I started working in this area in the year 2000, which, of course, was the future for many people. And I feel like that the number of vultures I've seen in this area since then has declined by probably as much as 50%. Now, that is by no means a scientific assessment. It is purely my observational assessment. But there are unquestionably fewer vultures than there were when I started working out here. That's apparently largely to do with the poisoning of carcasses outside these reserves, especially for traditional medicine. So if you're a traditional healer or a soothsayer, a vulture's head or vulture's body parts are particularly good, because apparently vultures are able to see into the future. They can see death. That's how they find carcasses. Now, whether or not you believe that is fairly irrelevant, simply because it is actually, you know, it's a belief that many people have, and I think that's a major, major issue. So no vultures around here. Were there to be a kill, the vultures would come. Let's go across to Jamie. She's got not a vampire, a waterbuck.
Our waterbuck didn't transform into an Inyala just magically, and you're not going mad. The reason is we changed our mind at the last minute, because I said everything's relaxed. He's not. That waterbuck bull is not relaxed. Look, he's also courting the lovely lady that is with him. But he has smelt something. And he's constantly sniffing the air to just double check. And I wonder if we're not going to return to our male line only to find that his lady friend has rejoined him, as James suggested. Waterbuck's got... The Nyala's actually got a watery eye. I think he might have been involved in a confrontation with a bush. As you know, Nyala bulls thrash their horns on the various trees to prove how manly they are, which might have... seems to have had the desired effect upon his lady companion, who's probably coming into estrus, same like what we were talking about with the lioness. So he's guarding her carefully against the attentions of other males. That's very clearly courting, the way that he doesn't let her out of his sight. The little waterbuck is, I think, going just about to pass out of view. There's a baby water... I know, it's still there. There's a little baby waterbuck. Horns just coming through, and I thought it looked too beautiful in this afternoon light. Little boy. I always wonder if the horns itch when they start to grow. Taking on a beautiful red colour in this afternoon light. So that was the waterbuck you were meant to be looking at before I got distracted by the Inyala, who's now chasing his lady friend towards us. He is herding her. Perhaps he hasn't smelt anything except the possibility of siring the next little Inyala lamb. He seems far more distracted by her. Perhaps that's just a posture he's adopting to make himself look big and impressive. Something similar to the bush thrashing that they very often do. Inyala do it, kudu do it. Sort of hitting the trees with their horns. There we go. He's looking bold and impressive with his fur rippling in the afternoon breeze. And there you go, you can actually see his watering eye. He's hurt his eye in some way. It might have been fighting with another male. I think most likely it's from... Oh, wait, lady, wait. Oh, shame. She wants to go that way. He wants to essentially shock her. I was wrong. I don't think he's sniffing anything except her. And he's got his head up like that as an impressive courting approach. That's what he's doing there. Natasha, just on the subject of alert animals, while we look at this beautiful view. Isn't he gorgeous? You wanted to know whether or not the alarm calls could have been at the vehicle. No. If they had been looking in the direction of Herbert and James, maybe they could have been spurred on by the presence of people on foot. But the Impala, the Inyala, none of the animals out here will alarm call at vehicles. They do not have an instinctive fear of them in the same way that they do of the shape of a leopard or a lion or a human walking on foot. Hey girl, you better keep your wits about you, because your companion certainly isn't going to. He's distracted by your Nyala, you wiles. Right, I can't stand the suspense anymore. Let's go back to the line and see if that lioness hasn't made her way back in that direction. I just have a funny feeling that's what's going to have happened. There's still no alarm calls from the baboons that we heard shrieking in the middle of that block. I couldn't say the word baboons there. Baboons. But Amy, the reason that you don't often see them is not because they're not habituated to vehicles, although I will say that they are more nervous than a lot of the other animals out here. We've only recently, once again, started seeing baboons on our live safaris. There's a couple of troops that have moved in to the area. I don't know whether it was because of the drought that most of them had moved south towards the river areas, the big trees with fruit. But no, we didn't see baboons for a very, very long time. I'm told that before I started working at Safari Live and for Wild Earth, the viewers used to see a group of baboons or a troop of baboons known as the Gowrie Gang on a very regular basis. However, the Gowrie Gang, it appears, moved off at some point. There's no restrictions on viewing them. The only restrictions really with baboons is to be very careful, it applies to all animals, that you don't leave rubbish lying about, edible rubbish. The dustbins have to be secured because baboons are very clever and they learn very fast where they can find regular access to food. Oof. Afternoon chill is setting in. Just keep an eye out in case this lioness decides to pop out somewhere here. There are lots of different eyes in the bush watching what's going on at all times. And that isn't just the mammal kind, but also the feathered kind. Let's go and have a look at James's Franklins.
There, everybody, is a crested Franklin. We don't know what's going on here, so we've just sort of walked into the area and we're hoping to find something. Well, we found a couple of interesting birds. I've also found a bulb, which I showed you last time I was on a walk, which was on my Sunday afternoon walk. And here it is. And I've got my knife out for effect, of course, because if you're a big, brave ranger, you must have a large knife in order to show how tough you are. See? See how tough I am, Vim? I can cut a bulb. It's a huge knife. Now, the interesting thing about this bulb is not the fact that I'm cutting it with my knife. It is the fact that Herbert tells me that it's very good for blood purification. And what exactly that means, I'm not sure. This comes probably from a kalenko or a lily of some sort. Very nice, Vim. And if you want to use it, what you do is you boil it. And you boil it with something like this apple leaf tree here. You can wait there, MP, I'll come back. So you take a piece of this apple leaf here. And then you take a piece of gwari bush. I can't see any gwari bush here. But you take some gwari, natal gwari and magic gwari. Here's natal gwari here. You take a piece of that. And you take three or four other kinds of tree. And you'd boil them up together, and then you would take that probably as a tonic. But if, of course, you're short of time and you don't have all of these things in your garden or in your sort of medicinal herb patch that you have outside your house, what you do is you take a piece of this, and that's elephant dung, and you boil that up with this, and that's because the elephant eats just about all the plants out here, and therefore you're likely to get most of what you need in the elephant dung, and you can boil that up, and apparently it's just as effective, and I think that's rather brilliant, don't you? Very nice. Let me just take this knife out before I cut myself to pieces. Let's have a look inside this dung here. And of course, elephant dung, one of my favourite things out here because it smells so very delicious once it's aged properly. Vim, would you like to try?
Let me try. good year.
Good, it's a good vintage, isn't it? Everybody, take a deep breath in. On the count of three. One, two, three. And what you've smelt there is the earth, basically. You've smelt earth, you've smelt tannins, and you've smelt basically bush potpourri, if you like. Now, as I was saying earlier this morning, nothing out here goes to waste. This has been devoured by some subterranean dwelling termite. And they've eaten it away, left their little mound about, and they would have lived in here for a little while, eaten what they wanted, and then disappeared. Where they disappeared, I don't know. This dung is probably only about a week or two old. So despite it being what we've described as a very good vintage, you can see it's not that old. But what is interesting also is you can see how much water there was when it came out. And the important thing about that is that an elephant is totally, totally water dependent, which means that they have to drink all the time. And if they can't drink, obviously the digestive system is not going to function and they're really going to struggle. And so a drought like this, quite apart from being difficult for elephants because they can't find things to eat, is also difficult because they need the water to help their digestion along. Come with me, let us go along this way. We've kind of not given up, but we're not missioning on our tracking because we don't have any tracks. We've been wandering around this area for good nigh on 2 hours now, and we haven't really been particularly successful. So we're just going to hopefully bump into something, or we'll find lots of other little fun things to show you, like that bulb, for example. Now, if you have a knife, of course, you can't keep it in your pocket, because then people don't see how brave you are, so you must keep it on your belt, like I'm doing now. My knife's not very big, is it, VM? All right, now Jamie has gone back to the lion. She's over there. She's sort of over the top of this ridge here. And that's where we thought we heard the alarm calling from. So maybe there's a lioness knocking through here about to join her. Go and take a look.
I can't see any lioness. So the answer to the alarm call mystery may indeed never be solved. But for now, we've got the view of our male lion, who's just done us the service of having a little bit of a stretch. There you go. Hey boy, where's your lady gone? I am speaking softly because there is another vehicle in the sighting with us. Let's try and do another adjustment. Sorry everybody, fiddling with the microphone. Here we go. You definitely looking quite okay with the fact, quite accepting of the fact that his lioness companion has seemingly abandoned him. Can't quite tell whether or not she snuck away or if they just split up naturally. Of course, we spoke before about the history of the Birmingham boys. And we never quite came to the part where the Birmingham boys became four rather than five doodles. Nobody will ever know exactly what the cause of death for that other male lion was, for Scrapper or Tokolosh, depending on which name you called him by. The sort of the strongest contender was the fact that he had been injured in some way by a failed hunt, or maybe a successful hunt, but that he might have been kicked by a buffalo or giraffe or whatever it was they tackled, and that he had a collapsed lung. That seemed to be the predominant theory. And that actually came from Shanae and from one of Shanae's guests. Shanae, of course, being a guy that works on Inkoro. Now, initially, I was under the impression that they were going to do an autopsy. It subsequently seems as though that they weren't going to. They didn't. Obviously got the wrong message from somebody who was a bit confused. They never did an autopsy, so we'll never know the exact reason. But he did have a massive amount of internal bruising that was clearly visible, and he was ill for a considerable period of time. He was clearly struggling. He was very, very thin. I think a merciful end, actually, for him. I don't think he was terribly comfortable. Sad, but one of those natural realities of life, being a male lion, or a female lion, And that sort of injury can happen to either of the sexes. Heidi, there is a distinctive possibility that we are looking at the father of the brand new generation, the reinforcements to the Nkuhuma pride. Very dignified, aren't you, boy? Absolutely magnificent. Now, Heidi wants to know whether or not he will ever meet his cubs. Yes, he will. Absolutely. He probably already has. We don't know, of course, which Birmingham boy fathered the current set of cubs that we know exists. We certainly know that he has been working on fathering the cubs for Amber Eyes, the female that has somehow managed to ditch him. I'm not quite sure how. But he will at some point. All of the Birmingham boys are potential fathers at this stage. I think they've all been seen mating at one point or another with either the Sticks or the Nkuhuma females, the Nkuhuma pride. And they have been seen with the Sticks cubs before. So they will meet at some point. They'll come through. And lions don't tend to be what I would call hands-on fathers, although they are relatively tolerant of the attention and games of their offspring. They let the little cubs climb all over them, play with their tail, bite their tail, with only the odd grimacing snarl if the cubs take things a little bit too far, and maybe utilize those sharpened pointy cub teeth slightly too much. They're not winning any Fathers of the Year, but they certainly do spend a great deal of time wandering between the different prides, and they will encounter their cubs. Well, since our lion is so thoroughly active at present, let's go across to James, who is much more mobile.
Well, I'm not that mobile, everybody, but at least I've had the grace to stand to my feet when addressing you. This is a sour plum tree, and as Viam says, it looks almost exactly like a peach tree. And it makes fruits, very nice fruits, the opposite of what you have, what you might call a sour worm. You know those sort of sweets you get that are very sour on the outside and then very sweet on the inside. This is sort of the opposite. And Herbert was just telling me that if you want to make sour milk, and people out here do drink quite a lot of sour milk, so the fresh stuff tends to be not as favoured as the sour stuff, you take the fruit of this, the sour plum, you squeeze it into the milk and it turns it sour immediately, and apparently it makes a very delicious and refreshing drink. Now, the other thing we have here is a snail shell. Now this was, I think, probably the beginnings of a giant land snail, and you can see how it began growing there, where my finger is pointing now, and then it spiraled outwards, growing slower and slowly and slowly and slowly until it became very large, and it would eventually become probably about the size of my fist. That would be a giant land snail. Now, if you take the end of it off, so just those last few segments there, or the last two twirls, you crush it up, soak it in water, and if you have an eye infection or even a cataract, apparently, what you do is you squeeze that into your eye, and that will take away the pain and possibly even clear up the cataract. And I just think that's remarkable. Now, just about every piece of information I've given you on the last two walks that I've done, has been from Herbert. And you get plenty of book knowledge and you learn the book knowledge, but it's only really when you walk with somebody who's lived in this environment that you get an idea of how things are really used, and you get a true impression of how incredibly valuable the bush is to local people here, and how obviously contested these conservation spaces must be, because of course people were removed off these places. Come over here, Vimpy. Herbert has found yet another something amazing. Well, come in. Matanza. Oh, la. And astoundingly, I'm able to identify what we're going to show you now. You see here, see these two things here, and I'm going to cover them up again. They've just been uncovered. They're under a log. That there are two gecko eggs. Now, I know they're gecko eggs because the geckos out here only lay two eggs at a time, two or three eggs at a time. Most of the lizards and the skinks lay, I think, a few more than that, up to 20, and the snakes too. Well, that, I think, are two little gecko eggs, exactly the same as the gecko eggs that we found inside the buffalo skull during our little TV special. Isn't that amazing? So we will cover those up. Apparently they will be dormant for, I think, I'm sure, the whole of the winter. And then when summer comes, they'll hatch and the little gecklets will go off and see what they can find to eat. But, I mean, imagine the terror of hatching out of something so tiny and having to make your way in an environment that is, well, I mean, it's quite threatening if you don't know what it's about. I think that's really amazing. I'm just going to pick this thing and show you. Even this tiny, seemingly inconspicuous piece of grass, you just hold it in the sunlight, has got a spider living in it, or had a spider living in it. You can see there. Isn't that amazing? Might even be a cocoon of some kind. I think that's just too spectacular for words. Like shining golden honey coloured in the sun. Now, I've had a question come through. The question is, a good question. The name of the person who's given it has just taken the cake as the greatest Twitter handle in history. This, I have to lie down while I address you here. This question comes from Natsu the Dragon Slayer. Natsu the Dragon Slayer, you want to know how big it is that giant land snails get? Well, they get about the size of my fist, I suppose, which is not particularly big. And you want to know how long they live? Apparently up to about 10 years they live, Natsu the Dragon Slayer. But because you're a Dragon Slayer, of course, they don't really ever get big enough for you to have to be called in to worry about getting rid of them. You simply stomp on them, we'll get rid of them if you have an infestation. But Natsu the Dragon Slayer, thank you for getting hold of us. Please do it again. I know that there's nothing out here that would tempt you to come out here and offer your services, but you might like to come out here and see some of the predators that we have here, the lions and leopards, for example. No dragons in this particular part of the world. Have you seen a dragon here?
What about a monitor lizard?
A monitor lizard. Yes, we have a monitor lizard, of course, which is about the size of my stick. So also not much of a dragon. You wouldn't be able to slay it. Right. Sarah, I'm going to have to get your question again. I'm too amazed by Natsu the Dragon Slayer. I think that's so wonderful. You want to know what animals eat giant land snails? Sarah, something like a human being would eat a giant land snail. Herbert says he doesn't, but I know some people who do. Cook them up with whatever, and they taste of whatever you cook them in, I guess, a bit like a normal garden variety French snail. But also tortoises. You know the speaks-hinged tortoise? It's that funny little tortoise that's got a hinge on it, on its front. And apparently they are devourers of those things. Herbert has found something else here. So those would be one of the main predators. Birds, of course, many birds would eat giant land snails. For although they are giant, they are not very fearsome and not particularly difficult to get rid of should they attack you. But Natsu, well, should dragons ever come into this area, I'm very pleased that we now have contact from you. Should Daenerys Targaryen and her ilk come into this area? Good grief. Oh, wow. Herbert has found... Oh, wow. What kind? It's a baboon spider of some kind, eh? Look at this baboon spider that Herbert's found. And another one here. Now, this is a different kind of baboon spider from the ones that we normally find that are in the open. Can you see it there, Vim? It's an astonishing thing. We'll try and get you a better picture of it. There you go. There we are. Look at that. So it's about an inch long. And this, everyone, is a tarantula. I mean, it's basically, it's the same family as the tarantulas. I think it's probably pretty harmless to human beings. There are some species of baboon spider that are not dangerous to humans, but can give you a bit of a nip, and then you won't feel so good. And this might be one of them, because it does live under a log. And I think that I read that the ones that are a little bit damaging to us are these ones. So they don't dig a big hole like the baboon spiders that we find, say, on quarantine clearings, like the one we had during the Father's Day special. We had a wonderful baboon spider that unfortunately had been stung by a spider-hunting wasp. But that baboon spider lives under here in a sort of shallow, silk-lined depression. Isn't that amazing? We found one the other day, and it was much smaller than this. Let me just have a look at this. James Richard, you say, why is it that certain species of spiders are out and about while others are dormant? You'll find most of them are dormant. They're not out and about by any stretch. Herbert turned this log over to have a look underneath it, and that's why we saw the spider. It'll be lying there almost inert for the duration of the winter, especially a day like this. It was only apparently 8 degrees this morning. I don't believe it was anything like that, but it was cold this morning, definitely, and it's remained cold throughout the day. So they will stay pretty much dormant until the summer comes. And look at, there's another dormant thing inside here. Over there, you can see a millipede. There it is. And they too will be pretty much dormant until the rains come. If there was a little bit of moisture, these guys come bucketing out and see if they can eat some dead plant material that's been sort of rendered rotting by the moisture. Let's cover him up again. And we'll cover this guy up. There's another one here. We'll cover her up as well, probably a her. All right. Let me just go these over. You don't want to, all sorts of nasties inside there. There we go. Right, let's go back to the lion, see what they're doing. I suspect absolutely nothing. We're going to head back sort of towards the Jumapan.
James is mistaken. Our lion's been phenomenally active. He twitched his cheek once, and his feet are moving every now and again. But he is correct in one sense. Oh, look, there we go. We've even got an ear twitch. Oh, it's all go here. James is, of course, entirely correct. Nothing can sleep as comfortably as a male lion who knows that there's not much out here that's in any way a threat to him. That being said, I am very reluctant to move, and I'll explain to you exactly why. At some point, this chap is going to wake up. He's going to wake up and realize, although I think he knows already, that his lovely lady friend has long since left, and I suspect joined up with her pride mate in the drainage line. At that point, he's going to get lonely, and he's going to start feeling the pangs of hunger that inevitably come after 5 days of solid mating. So what that means is that he's going to want to find the rest of them, and he's going to do that through a contact call, and I'm really hoping that before the end of our sunset safari, our gentleman here is going to stand up and give us a full impression of why the lion is so extraordinary, hopefully with a full-bellied roar. Stay tuned, we'll have to wait and see, but for now, I don't think we're on our way. We're not quite there yet. For the moment, he is very happy to be fast asleep, but he gives us a lovely opportunity to examine him very closely, since we do happen to have the camera that will give us a closer perspective on a lion's magnificent anatomy. And we'll start off with his nose, which is starting to get patches of black. Now, it's not a reliable way of aging a lion, but in general, kind of like giraffe, when giraffe get darker with age, as a general rule, lions' noses tend to go blacker as a general rule. He's starting to come into his prime. You can see how his mane has filled out. He now no longer looks as though he's got a little bit of a mohawk, and he's starting to actually go dark around the chest as well. And it's a very important time of a male lion's life. They've got a very, very short time period in which they are dominant. Now, Douglas, yes, absolutely. If the Birmingham male was still in charge when his cubs had reached sexual maturity, so the cubs that they've just sired by the Styx cubs and by the Nkuhuma cubs, you wanted to know if they would breed with them, if they could, absolutely they would. Lions have no compunctions about inbreeding, and as soon as a female starts to come into estrus, it means a male, any available male that would find her will mate with her. That being said, the chances of that in a natural wild system like this with a concentration of male lions that we have essentially exists to stop that from occurring. So the pride takeovers, a male only really has about a 2-year period if he's lucky. I'm sorry, was that bad news? It'll be okay, boy. It'll be okay. Don't listen to what I'm saying. Take comfort in your dominance now. For it is a limited time period. 2 years, maybe 3, depending on how successful they are, before younger, stronger males come in. And it's one of those facts of life. Chances are, if there are any new cubs that have been sired during a pride takeover, they will be killed by incoming males. The females will be brought back into estrus, and the new dominant males will mate with them. And that's just a way that nature has evolved in order to prevent the possibility of inbreeding. But it still happens. It's one of the big reasons why closed systems, in other words, the smaller private reserves of South Africa and the world, have to manage their lion population. Because absolutely, their instinctive response is to mate them. And I mean, we saw it even with Junior, the young male of the Nkuhuma pride that has since moved off on his own and even found himself a friend. He was getting to that age where he was starting to show more interest, an almost Oedipal interest in his mother, or his potential mother, or his aunt, one of the females of the Nkuhuma pride. Now, the system has very cleverly evolved to prevent that from happening where possible. And the Matimba males, if they were still dominant now, we know that the young sub-adult female from the Nkuhuma pride, she's now an adult, fully an adult, and she was seen mating with one of the Birmingham boys, or at least attempting to mate with one of the Birmingham boys, not too long ago. If the Matimba males were still in power, so to speak, the previous males of this area, they would be mating with her, even if there is a very strong possibility that they, in fact, fathered her to start with. Very, very common to have that incestuous... You can't really describe it as incestuous because they don't know any better. We've been watching our male mate with the female producing our next generation of cubs. Ooh, starting to get very chilly. Mike, the average duration that a lion will mate for less than 30 seconds, if that is what you're asking. In a broader sense, for 30 seconds, 4 times an hour for roughly 5 right up until 7 days. So that's how long the estrus cycle lasts. So it's a case of quantity over quality for a lion. And the reason they do that is because it's called induced ovulation. So the repeated stimulation causes the female to ovulate, so the repeated mating causes her to ovulate. And it's only towards the sort of middle or end part of her estrus cycle that she will actually, fertilization will occur and she will fall pregnant. Clearly failed with Amber Eyes a couple of weeks ago, because she was mating with one of the Birmingham boys not too long ago, and clearly she didn't fall pregnant that time. So it doesn't always work, and there are such things as false estruses that do occur. And what that means is that she's mating with a male, and he's induced her fertilization, but it gives a time period during which another bigger, better, stronger male with a better genetic line might come along and usurp that male's position. And what often happens with coalitions, which is why there's actually a minimum level of conflict between the coalition members, is what often happens is actually the male tires before the female does, and another coalition member steps in and takes over, which is why it's impossible for us to determine exactly which of the males has fathered the cubs. Similar situation to what happens with leopards, female leopards mating with as many males as possible. A lioness is not what I would describe as terribly fussy when it comes to potential mating opportunities. And hello to Wesley watching in Durban. Wesley, I've just come back from Durban. When I left there, the weather was absolutely extraordinary. I went there with Brent. We had a marvelous time. We got incredibly lucky. I hope your weather is still as glorious as it was when we left. Wesley is a new viewer and would like to know how long a lion can sleep for. Lions are absolute in terms of all of the... Oh, big stretch. If there were a sleeping Olympics that could be held out here, the lions would be the undisputed champions, sleeping for up to 20, 22 hours a day sometimes, particularly when they're round a kill and they've got full bellies. They kind of get up, munch a little bit, then go back to sleep again. The lions are champion cat nappers, as well as deep sleepers, clearly. Oh, we're getting signs of movement here. There was a claw. There's a claw poking out. There's two claws poking out. There's the dew claw, the strongest claw. A bit earlier, our male lion was actually twitching in his sleep. His paws looked like he was running in his dreams, just like your pet cats and dogs do at home. Gracie, who is 8 years old, as always, I'm so glad that you're watching, Gracie. You wanted to know if lions have bad dreams. I don't know, Gracie. I definitely think that they do have dreams. I'm relatively certain that they do have dreams. There's no other reason why they would kind of run in their sleep. But I hope they don't. They always look so peaceful, Gracie, that I don't think really that they have bad nightmares. And of course, if they ever do have nightmares, then because they're social cats, a lot of the time there's a friend to comfort them, whether it's their mom or their sister, or in his case, a brother or a cousin, one of the other Birmingham boys. And I think he's going to be hopeful that he can find them again tonight. And speaking of tonight and the gradual approach of the evening, let's go across to James, who's looking west.
More accurately, northwest, everybody. There is the sun sinking down below the western horizon. Very pretty. We're not lurking around here too much, and I'll show you why. We've just come across a buffalo. He's moving away from the water now, and you can, if we just look through there, you can see them all starting to move away from the water. They're going off to do their evening grazing, and in fact there are a couple of them coming down into the Juma Dam here. And they're probably going to head out sort of towards the sun there, probably off in that sort of direction. So what we're doing is we're moving down through the drainage now, and then we'll make our way up to quarantine and back home. Keeping an eye on them, they are starting to get moving now, so come with us. We're going to just try and skirt them. We obviously don't want to come across them now, because it is getting a little bit darker. The sun is setting, and we'll be back home by the time it's dark. So we'll ease our way down through here. Herbert's eyes peeled, his ears peeled, his nose peeled, and thank you all very much for your kind compliments about his efficacy on these walks. I think he has been an absolute boon to us. Let's go this way. And nothing I've told you about the plants and things, like I say, you're right. I thought we nearly lost VM into the drainage there. And nothing I've told you about the plants of this area over the last two little walks, everyone, have been anything that I've learned from books. It's all come directly from Herbert, and so I'm hoping over the months to come I shall learn even more. We gave up on those leopard tracks because I'm just not sure what was going on there. They were so very fresh, but I know that you've heard us say that and then not seen the leopard, so I'm not going to say anything further about where or what happened to that leopardess. Maybe she'll turn up as Jamie pulls back into camp, and I think it's nice that Jamie's around here, you know, for the last bits of the drive. We'll be kind of out of commission in the next 20 minutes or so. But Jamie was close around the camp, like she did last night. She was around the camp. Now just watch your heads, everybody, especially VM. Let's move this out of the way so we can get through. Jamie, we'll see you the other side.
Well, James starts to head northwest in the direction of camp. It seems as though his signal starts to disappear. As you can see, our champion sleeper is forging ahead, increasing his lead significantly over other opponents, such as the Franklin, that are still squawking off in the distance, giving us a lovely view of his black eyelashes. And his wonderfully characterful face. I always think that male lions that have scars across their face are always, it's a story. It's like their history mapped out across them. I find it absolutely fascinating. Beautiful, unblemished male lions are extraordinary, but the ones with scars have stories to tell. Now, as we wait for him to start his evening vocalizations, which I have almost promised, and I'm really hoping he decides to stir himself, although the Birmingham boys tend to be late risers. Sherlock Holmes, you want to know how often we hear lions roar? Sherlock Holmes, what does the evidence tell you? Can you draw your conclusions? Sherlock, it's a very strange moment. Sherlock, we hear them pretty much every night, I would say. We basically fall in the centre of the Birmingham boy territory, their home range and their territory, as well as the centre of the Nkuhuma pride. They roar. Oh, there, those claws. There's some positive signs there. The odd stretch that suggests that he might just be thinking about stirring himself and maybe giving us a call. So the male lion's roaring plays a very important part in basically expressing to other males that they are there and that they are dominant in the area, and essentially is almost like confrontation avoidance, if I could term it that way. It's a way of establishing their territory without physically fighting for it, although that, of course, does occur. And particularly with male lions, can be incredibly violent, often resulting in the death of one of the parties. He's not thinking about that right now. He's thinking about something else. Who knows what it may be? Providing a perfect resting spot for the number of flies that are buzzing around him. And just look at how many have gathered. A lion is a wonderful creature, but it is not a very clean one. Flies fluttering about, picking up whatever debris they can have. And of course, this camera does provide us with an extraordinary close-up glance of the lion's fur itself and the flies fluttering about that slightly matted section. I wonder what he's been lying in. Lion's not terribly fussy when it comes to where they put themselves, what they roll in, and in fact sometimes deliberately seek out the smelliest thing to place themselves in. Now, of course, we've got this close-up look. Barbara, now, you are right. We are fortunate to have this phenomenal view of the lion. And it probably does provide us with a somewhat different perspective. I certainly can tell you, Barbara, that since I've started working for Wild Earth and doing these live safaris, I've come to notice details about the animals that I never noticed before. That being said, would I think you would be disappointed on a real-life safari? Absolutely not. Unequivocally not. It is wonderful, and we're very privileged to be able to bring you this. And it's wonderful that you can watch this live from across the corners of the globe. But Barbara, I don't think you would be disappointed, because nothing beats the feeling of sitting with these animals and the privilege that we get to experience every day. I've just found out that a friend of mine, Courtney, has been watching this live safari, and she is watching from the United States, but she was one of the first ever guests, she was there as a student, but I suppose guests that I ever took out on safari, and perhaps she can attest to it. That's a wonderful way to watching across the globe, but it is just as special being here in the flesh. Now, James, I think, will be wending his merry way home, in whatever direction that may be, since it is starting to get dark. So let's go across to him.
Merry way home indeed, everyone, and the merry little flower I found. The very last flower of the winter, it would seem. This is
I have committed a grievous error. Unfortunately, James has disappeared off bushwalk a little bit sooner than expected. I have committed a grievous error, a most foolish one, and a rather a rookie error. I forgot to bring my other jacket. So I'm going to sit here and shiver quietly and wish I had a nice warm mane to wrap myself in, although I do have quite a lot of hair. Perhaps I could wrap that around my neck and keep myself warm. Oh, but I've got James's leggy blankie, come to think of it. I was sitting on James's leg blanket, but I'm now going to utilize James's leg blanket for its purpose. Terribly silly of me. I don't know what I was thinking, and well, obviously wasn't. Right. Oh, it's all go, go, go here in Lion World. He did stretch once. It's only when he starts to yawn and perhaps lick his paws that we can be optimistic about the prospects of movement. But we've still got 45 minutes yet, and we're definitely going to find ways to fill that time period before we reach the end of the sunset safari. I don't want to leave, because if I do leave, he's going to disappear. And Natsu, the dragon slayer, a bold proclamation there. When does the lion get hungry? Well, Natsu, when does the dragon get hungry? He'll be hungry now. He's absolutely starving. A lion will eat roughly once every 3 days, depending on what the size of the animal is that they have killed. And of course, lions are very good, as are all predators out here, at gorging themselves, eating as much as they can, as quickly as they can, in case they lose their kill, either to hyenas or other lions. So Natsu, roughly every 3 or so days, he must be absolutely starving. So they can go for up to a week, even longer in extreme cases, without managing to catch a meal. With a hunting success rate of somewhere around 12%. So 12% of every kills, 12 to 20% of the kills that they initiate actually result in a meal for them. Well, the hunts they initiate, sorry, that makes more sense as a sentence. It stands to reason that occasionally they do go relatively hungry. Right, it seems as though a bushwalk has managed to get up and running again. Let's try go back to them.
I'm afraid, everybody, we left you when I was looking at this very beautiful flower. We've come a little bit higher up, and there's some buffalo there standing on the wall of the Juma Dam. And like I said, they're going off to have a little bit of a meal. Last time I came past here with Steph and Brian, and the buffalo left the pan, and we were just walking across the dam wall. We thought, we're quite far away, we're not going to do anything. They formed a phalanx of six, and they came straight towards us, and we had to actually run up this hill as they got away from us. We're a long way from them now. I don't think there's any danger of them doing that. They're well aware of us. They've definitely seen us, but they're not particularly harassed by our presence. And the buffalo, of course, they will tell you, the hunters will tell you, that they are the most dangerous animals in all of Africa. Well, if you threaten them, yes, they probably are. But I have walked to within... I've been walking through the bush like this and spotted a buffalo that's been watching me chewing its cud for ages, not more than 5 or 6 feet away. And it's just lain there and stared at me. If you don't show intent to do them harm, most of the time, they're absolutely fine. We're going up onto quarantine clearings now. We'll see what's coming out into the open. Hello, Rain. You're 16 years old and you want to know what hyenas do when they see us on foot. Rain, Normally they run away. I had a rather interesting incident the other night, actually. I walked out of my room. No, I didn't. I heard some scrabbling in the dustbin, and I knew it was a hyena, so I walked out of my room, and I was, of course, dressed in my birthday suit at the time, and the hyena took fright, and he did run off into the darkness, and then he came back. And it was quite interesting how he knew where the shadows were, he knew where he'd be able to see me and where he wouldn't be able to see me. And what he did was he'd come closer, and then I'd shout and he'd go just into the shadows, and he'd come closer again and he'd look at the dustbin and try to decide. And I, of course, didn't want to rush out of my room in my birthday suit in case everybody else woke up and tried to chase the hyena as well. And so eventually I flicked a towel at him and he ran away. That's normally what happens with hyenas, but I did have an experience somewhere around this time last year where I was following a hyena through the bush. I was following some other tracks. Well, more accurately, I was hoping to follow some other tracks, and I happened across a hyena, and she looked at us, and then she moved off, and I carried on walking, and then I looked up, and she was watching me from about 20 meters away. That's about 70 feet. So I clapped my hands in order to make her go away, and she wouldn't. She just stood there. So I clapped again, and I shouted, and I took two or three steps towards her, and then she kind of walked off. Now, that's very unusual for hyena behavior. What you don't want, though, is for a hyena to get its confidence up, because if a hyena's got its confidence, you'll be in a lot of trouble. But I haven't heard, I don't think I've heard of a record of a human being taken by a hyena during the middle of the day while walking. I don't think I've heard of that. At night, they're a different story, and especially if you're lying down. And that's why just about every time there's an incident with a hyena, what's happened is people are camping quietly in the bush, and it's hot, so they leave their tents open. And if you leave your tent open, the hyena, of course, will come and stick its head into the tent, and then they'll pull you out because you're not upright and they know you're sleeping. But not 99 times out of 100, you'll be absolutely fine if you saw a hyena on foot. You can see the sun has disappeared over quarantine clearings, and there is not a great deal going on up here. We'll sort of walk up towards the fireside chat area and then head back for home, I think. We're not far from home now, only about 3 minutes. Tim, you want to know if Viam has to walk sideways when walking next to me? He's currently walking straight with his arms at a sort of awkward angle and trying to watch where he's walking and keep the focus at the same time. It's quite an impressive thing to be viewing, actually. Not always. Ideally, if we're walking through the bush, then he'll walk behind me, Herbert often in front. And then if we're in the open like this, it's quite nice because now I can look you in the eye, Tim. Otherwise, I'm constantly doing that, or you're looking at what was termed by one of our viewers my bubble butt, which, of course, is not something you should have to do by choice at all. Wait. We're not in Lob Kualan. Come here. There are elephants there. And baboons. A whole herd of ellies. And baboons have seen us. They're jumping out of the trees. Now, can you see the baboons at all, Vimpy? The baboons are just behind the elephants there. You can see them way in the distance. I'm afraid we can't get any closer to the baboons because the elephants are now blocking our way. We're going to carry on this way. All right, the lions are moving. We're going to get around the elephants. Go and enjoy the lions. We'll see you shortly.
The lion is no longer in the place he was. He is up and about. He gave two yawns. And he is now making his way down the road, having wandered past us. Come on, boy. Give us a call. Here we go. A lion, male lion in all his glory, looking to see if he can't find his buddies. His buddies are on Buffle's Hook, by the way. There's three male lions there. And I've just been listening to reports on the Game Drive channel, so he's going in the wrong direction for now. If indeed those are the Birmingham boys that they found, which stands to reason, perhaps he's going to look for his lady. Perhaps he's known where she is all along. I doubt it, though. I think he knows where she is, but I think they're done with their mating moments. But I'm optimistic that he's going to give us a little bit of a contact call at some point. See if we can't pull up alongside him quickly before we hit an obstacle. As we drive along him, the time that we've spent with him, it's sort of been easy to imagine him to be a little bit of a house cat. You know, he just looked so relaxed and content with life. But it's really, really important to remember that these are truly wild lions. They're just wild lions that are comfortable with the presence of the vehicle. Bun Bun, you were wondering how aggressive a lion can really be. And the answer is, for the most part, it depends on whether you're talking about towards other lions or towards human beings. Is he just going to go and mark this bush, or is he going into that block? I think he's just going to mark it. Bun Bun, towards human beings, it depends on the lions themselves as he marks his territory. Spraying urine, rubbing. There we go. Sorry, Bun Bun. Little moments of contact calls. Try and get to him before he goes into the full throated roar that he is going to do at this point. He's giving soft guys, where are you guys? She left me. I'm all alone. But while I catch up with him, James has got an elephant.
Look at that, everybody. Lovely, peaceful scene of elephants in the dusk. I think they can see us. I'm not sure if they can smell us or not. I'll just test the wind. The wind is blowing slightly towards them, not really though. So they may pick up our scent on the wind. If they looked up, they'd see us for sure. They could probably hear my voice if they listened very carefully. But they're very, very peacefully eating. We're about, what does your focus say, Vim? About 80 meters away from them. 250 meters. 117 meters away from them. And they're very relaxed. Isn't that stunning? And what a very peaceful thing to be looking at. I think that's just marvellous. Anyway, everyone, we're going to say goodbye to you. We can look at these elephants for a little bit longer, absolutely, and I think we'll do that. But this will probably be our last segment. You can see it's getting a little bit dark now. And so from Herbert, thank you, Herbert, for your efforts, and from VM and I, well, it's a fond farewell. And a big thanks, of course, to the Final Control, but mostly to all of you for coming on our adventurous walk today. I hope you had a good time. We'll leave you with the elephants and hand you back to Jamie and the moving lions. See you tomorrow at 6:30.
Here we go. Our lion very much on the move. And I'm going to try and do this backwards whilst keeping an eye on him and trying to keep the spotlight steady. Bun Bun, on the subject of lions being aggressive, they generally are afraid of people during the day on foot. They're not aggressive towards people in the vehicles at all, unless you really have shown them a great deal of disrespect or if they've got a little bit confused by your intentions. But they're generally not a threat to people on foot either during the day. It is at night. Oh, are we going to... thought he was going to call there, but at the moment I think he's just sneezing. It is at night that the lion is the true master. Now you'll find that for each and every one of us, with our respect that we have for the bush, we will never go walking about at night, ever. Whoops, let's try not to hit the tree. Towards other lions, that is a very different story. Is he going to go in here? let him come past us. Oh, he is going to go into this block. Come on, boy. Give us a call. We're going to try and stay with him. There we go. Come on, boy. Half-hearted calls. I don't want to turn my engine on while he's calling, but he's stopped now. Okay, let's try to keep up with him. All right, let's try and stay with him for as much as we can of the sunset safari. I think he's going to cut this corner. I'm not even going to bother to go off-road. I'm just going to try and stay with him along the road itself. I think he's going to pop out close to Voyatella Dam. I'm hoping that's what he's going to do. For the moment, he is still visible from the road. He's going in that direction. Let's go around the corner. While he looks for his buddies, Tony, welcome to the Sunset Safari. I'm hoping we're going to get you a full-bodied male lion roar. And you want to know whether or not he can just sniff out the location of where he needs to go. The answer is, to an extent, quite possibly, if the lady is still around or if one of the males is close enough. But what he's most likely going to do is listen for their responses. Okay, it does get very, very thick in here, so I'm going to let him move into the block and I'm going to try and catch up with him around the corner. And hopefully he's going to keep calling, so he'll give us an opportunity to know exactly where he is. Let's just go around here. Let me just make sure there's no lioness either while we drive along. So Tony, he's going to rely for now on his hearing, and of course his hearing is far better than our hearing. Our lion roar we can hear for up to a good couple of miles on a cold winter's evening. He will be able to hear it even further. And he's hoping that his buddies are going to be listening out for him and will give him a call back in response. He might even be going to the Juma Dam for a drink. Okay, we'll stop. Where is he going to come out? I'm trying to calculate his trajectory. I don't want him to sneak behind us. I think he's going to come out somewhere here. There's a game path that runs just along through the block and comes through here. Let's just stop and listen. Enjoy the sounds of the evening for a moment. Might take a little bit longer just because he's stopping to mark territory along the way, so we'll keep an eye behind us as well. Come on, boy, give us a clue. It always astounds me, Tony, just to expand a little bit on your question, just how amazing it is that these animals do manage to find each other. It applies to the females as well as the males. And they get split up for long periods of time. And they seem to have, even when the females are silent, they seem to be able to find each other relatively quickly. Now, Andrew's just trying to get a hold of me on the game drive comms. I'm just going to respond to him quickly. Go ahead, Andrew. He's coming through there. Something just ran ahead. Andrew, he's just got mobile now. He was mobile southeast. He's coming through the block between Mvubu and Gari cut line. I think he's going to pop out towards the dam. I'm trying to relocate now. Something came dashing through here. There he is.
Affirm, I've got him. He's making his way towards Vertilla Dam now. Hey! I'm glad we didn't try and get through that block. I'm hoping he's not... don't go in there, boy. He's looking ahead at the buffalo. I'm just going to drop my lights. I don't think he's going to hunt it on his own, but I'm going to take my lights off the situation just in case. The buffalo hasn't realized that he's there. The lion not really showing much interest, but you never know, they're opportunists. That big buffalo is probably a bit much for a big male lion like him while he's on his own. Ah, no, he's going to go into the drainage. He doesn't even want to go near the buffalo. He knows that that buffalo is going to chase him. You never know with lions, but I doubt that he would be prepared to challenge something of that size on his own. Now, the Birmingham boys, of course, have a fearsome reputation as buffalo hunters. Okay, let's go onto the dam wall. We'll catch up with him there. I cannot get the vehicle through there. Excuse me, beefalo. Now, I've been casting aspersions upon his energy levels throughout the day, but Gail, yes, he would absolutely walk many, many miles until he relocated his group. A lion can cover 10, 15 miles in one night. Oh dear. He's behind us. Oh yes, so he is. Thank you very much, Dave. Well, there's not much we can do about that now. I thought he was continuing on through the drainage line. He's popped out there, as it happens. Hello, boy. I'm sorry. Which way are you planning on going? He's gonna come right past us. How cool is that? Right up next to the vehicle. Sorry, boy. Didn't mean to do that. I thought he was going to carry on along the drainage line, but it looks as though he was just ducking those buffalo. But yes, he will walk many, many miles. Oh, he's been spotted by the Impala. One keen-eyed Impala has already seen him. This is awesome. What a way to finish off our sunset safari. Hopefully, he will make good on the promise to give us a proper full call. Oh, it's not just us watching the lion. Let's have a look at a different perspective of things while I catch up. How cool is this? Okie dokie, and we're back on the vehicle. Attempting to catch up with our male lion. Where's he going to decide to go from here? Oh dear, he's going to go for a drink, I think. Hopefully. If he goes into the dam itself. Okay, I'm going to take the spotlight off him for now. He's going towards the dam. I think he's thirsty. Let's go there. We'll get a perspective of him drinking. So while we go around, let's have a look at the different perspective. Andrew, he's already at the Wildebeest pan. He's coming for a drink here. And a very big thank you to our wonderful Zoomy, who's doing a fantastic job of helping me in staying with this lion. There we go. Okay, we've arrived. Sorry for all of you watching the waterhole cam. I'm going to try and duck around you so I don't block your view. Awesome. Obviously, he's clearly been spotted by the impala. You are going mental. Shame, he was very thirsty. It has been a hard few days. Mating lions do not eat. They do not really... They will drink, but they won't eat. And he probably actually hasn't had a drink in a while. Now that was his first port of call. I'm just going to be quiet so you can hear the sounds around us. Dave, I'm going to take my spotlight off him. There's something... Oh, never mind, it's an impala, never mind. I thought perhaps there might be a leopard sneaking up on the scene as well. Oh, so thirsty. I can actually hear him lapping. He is so thirsty. What an awesome afternoon this has been. We really have been, we really are incredibly fortunate to get to spend time with these phenomenal animals, and we've had some extraordinary cat luck. There the baboons go. Wonderful opportunity to just listen to the sounds of the evening. As he decides where to go next, having sated his thirst, looking off in the direction of the setting sun, northwest to be precise, sniffing the air. Come on, boy, give us a call. Deborah, our armchair traveller. Never mind, sorry, we'll come back to it. Doesn't matter how many times you hear that sound when you're right next to it. Did you feel your chest vibrate, Dave?
I did.
My foot was vibrating on the accelerator. It's incredible. Absolutely incredible. And to the viewer who asked about being, or Barbara, who asked about being disappointed in seeing these things in the flesh, I have to tell you that there is nothing more stirring than the sound of a lion roaring in the fall of night right next to your vehicle. It is absolutely incredible. I'm so glad we got to hear that before the end of the safari. Awesome, absolutely awesome. Gives you a perspective of his, the distance that he was from us there. Okay, he's going to make life really tricky for us. We can't follow him there, but I think he's going to pop out on Mvubu Road. Then we'll go back and see if we can't stay with him. Hopefully we get him one more time before the end of the sunset safari. I'm not going to try and bash my way through there at night, especially not with Wendy somewhat out of commission. Yay, that was so cool. Oh, come on, Rust Bucket. Into reverse you go. Sure. Thanks very much, Zumi, for your fantastic work. Thank you, Zumi. Give him a wave, Dave. You did. Well done. Oh, just going to quietly dislocate my shoulder quickly. And not blind poor Andrew, who is watching us from the dam wall. Go back, Andrew, go back. Go back. Yay. What an awesome experience that always is. Sorry to Deborah, whose question got rudely interrupted. It's okay, Impala. Just turning all my lights off so we don't contribute to their level of anxiety. Andrew, is that you? Copy that, I'll be right behind you. Cool. Andrew and I are on the same page, he's just doing a quick U-turn. It gives us a chance to answer poor Deborah's question. It got completely knocked flying due to the vocalization of the lion. The flicking of the tail does indeed mean something other than just irritation that flies it, but again, it depends very much on the circumstances. So a lion's tail, along with its ears and its facial expression, are the most important indicators of its mood. Now, I don't know if you've got cats at home, Deborah, but if you do, or if you know friends with cats, you'll know when they thrash their tail from side to side, they are incredibly annoyed. And the same applies for lions. When a lion's tail is thrashing, you know that something is irritating it. When it's flopping, when it's lying down and the tail's flopping and not much has changed in the animal's body language, then that isn't to do. I just don't want to blind Andrew, by the way. That's why the lights are all off. Then it isn't in response to any kind of aggravation. It's just flicking flies away. The same applies to our leopards as well. And that, of course, is why... One of the reasons why a lion's tail is... I better turn my lights on or we're going to drive off the damn wall. One of the reasons why a lion's tail... Oh, there he goes. Oh, no, that's a buffalo. Never mind. My mistake. In my defense, it is dark. It's why a lion's tail... One of the reasons why a lion's tail is tipped with black. So as to emphasize its importance... along with the black on the back of the ears. Oh, yep, we go. Everybody hold on. Okay, I'm gonna let Andrew get a little bit ahead of us. There's no point in both of us being exactly the same place and exactly the same time. I've got my game drive comms in my ears, so I'll be able to hear if he relocates him. And remember how I said that he was going in the wrong direction when I said he was trying to catch up with his friends? It's because the rest of them are up towards the north and he wasn't going in the wrong direction. I should have given him more of the benefit of the doubt. He was going to have a drink and then up to the north. Now, Brad, you were wondering, while we shine our spotlights on the lions, and I think it's a concern that many, many viewers have, whether or not it actually bugs them or annoys them or causes them some kind of discomfort. So for a nocturnal animal, no. Something like a lion or a leopard, it does have a tremendous ability, a capacity to reflect and bounce that light back out of its eyes. So we only shine our spotlight on nocturnal animals, but you'll notice that I do so with a degree of care. So I don't shine the spotlight straight into the center of his face. What I do is I often bounce it off the ground if there is a light patch of ground, or I will shine it indirectly onto his side, his shoulder, or his stomach, so that it's the It's the reflection of the light that illuminates him a bit. So we're it's very important to have good spotlight ethics. How are you there, Dave? Am I throwing you off the back again?
Nope.
Okay, well done, good man. Oh, sorry, that's an impala. Stop here, let Andrew get ahead. There's a ninjala in the direction of the fiery sunset. Let's just listen for him. He's going to call again. The glory of the African bush at night. I wonder if he's going to sneak up behind us again. He's already done that once. Copy that, Andrew. I'm going to stand by here. I'm switched off already. Okay, so now we just play a waiting game. I think we'll give it a... hold on. So there's other lions on Champagne Road. One can only wonder at the name Champagne Road and why it might be called thus. But Champagne Road, as far as I know, is on Buffalo's Hook. And that's exactly where he's going to be going. They've probably been calling in response to him. One male, sorry, it's just the one male. But they're going to keep us updated. Now, Gail, speaking about them contact calling to each other, in terms of how far it will travel, well, Gail, it depends if you're talking about human ears or lion ears. For us, we can probably, it depends on the person's hearing as well. Brent, who can hear the sound of a lion roaring at probably what feels like about 10 miles, and yet at the same time have to turn his movie up incredibly loudly. It's an interesting thing. He can probably hear a lion roaring at about 5 miles on a cold night. Maybe a little bit less, but on a cold evening that the sound actually travels further. For a lion, I would say that they can hear each other roaring at about a distance of 10 or so miles, if not even further. The average human ear, not Brent Leo Smith's amazing supersonic hearing, probably will pick up a lion roaring at about between 4 to 5 miles. Of course, our lion has probably heard the other lions call back already, and he has gone silent because he doesn't need to call again. He's just going to keep walking. Andrew is standing by just a little bit further ahead. We are just going to wait for a couple more moments. Tasha, now that he has finished his time with his lady companion and he has moved off to find his buddies, he won't wait around until the cubs are born, so he's got about a 3-month waiting period until the products of this particular mating session come into fruition, if indeed they do, if indeed it does result in fertilization. So his cubs will not be born any time before the next 3 months. He's not going to stick around. He's going to go and rejoin the rest of his buddies. He might even find another lady in the interim to mate with. There are several lionesses around the area. There's 5 in the Nkuhuma Pride, and there's a couple more further to the south. He might even encounter one belonging to the Talamati Pride up further to the north. He could mate with any of those females. So basically what male lions do, they don't have their pride that they stick around with in the way that they might have been conveyed in The Lion King. So Mufasa had his pride, and that was just how things were. That's not how it works with male lions. They don't even really have a pride that they spend a great deal of time with. They have a territory, and they have a couple of ladies within that territory, and they might go and join up with them, maybe feed on the kill, that if the ladies maybe steal the kill, in most cases, if I'm completely honest, from the females. And then they go off on their territorial patrols. They spend most of their time with each other. It's interesting about the Birmingham boys is that they appear to have scattered off in a way. They've split up, but I suppose it comes with maintaining a large territory. Copy that. Thank you, Andrew. I'm just going to continue on north along Vubu Road for a little bit. Oh, that was my presenting voice, not my Game Drive channel voice. But anyway, I think the guides are probably used to it. Oh, hello, Impalala. Let's dim our lights. It's an interesting sound coming from Rusty. I'm sure it didn't sound like that earlier. It's one of the other reasons why I didn't follow him off-road. With Wendy out of commission, I don't want to put any more pressure on our vehicles. And driving off-road at night, we just run that risk of hitting a hole or a stump that we might have seen during the day. Sorry, guys. Alright, I think to be completely honest with you, we're probably not going to find him before the end of the sunset safari, but I'm so glad that we did at least get to experience the moment where he called right next to the vehicle. There is nothing quite like that experience. Oh, let's get ourselves over the bumpy part. Now, we were fortunate enough when the Birmingham boys first came to power in this area. We were sitting on quarantine clearings with them, and we had all five of them calling at once all around us. It was absolutely breathtaking. Now, it's not often that you get a group of five males all calling at the same time, and it's the most primitive and yet amazing experiences that you can ever have out here in the bush. Now, I think we're going to leave our male lion to his explorations of the evening, and we wish him, of course, the best of luck in relocating his buddies. And speaking of that incredible moment, Shelley, in Chicago, on a broader level, do I have a favorite cat sighting? It is so hard to choose, Shelley, it really is. I have to be honest though, maybe this is a little bit predictable, but I can't help it. The time that we have spent with, maybe it's just because it's so fresh in my mind, the time we have spent with Shadow's cubs and recently with Karula's cubs and now recently with Shadow's cubs yesterday, I have to say that those come pretty high up on my list of experiences. And I think it's just because of the amount of time we spend with those animals and the level of attachment that we have to them, which is a dangerous thing, but at the same time, we've just been so spoiled. Okay, we've moved out of the Impala herd, so I can pop the spotlight back on. And I think we leave the lion search for now. Keep an eye on the Juma Dam camera though, because whilst the male is leaving the area, I didn't find any tracks of that female disappearing. So keep an eye out, because they might come through for a drink. Dave, do you have a favorite cat sighting? I know, I agree with Dave. We had the most phenomenal sighting, even though it was only 5 minutes long. That experience with Shadow's cub, seeing her for the first time. We're talking about leopard cubs, by the way, for viewers who did miss out on that and are new to the show. We're talking about leopard cubs. And wow, but that little cub was absolutely extraordinary. Hissing at mum. That was very interesting. Oh dear, well, sooner than expected actually. The end of the sunset safari has rushed up upon us once again, and you will just have to wait until morning before we can unravel the mysteries of whatever the African bush has to hold overnight. It's definitely one of my favorite times of day. Hopefully we'll get more lions roaring, whatever else happens to be around, and we will see you tomorrow morning for the sunrise safari. So for now, thank you to Dave for his fantastic camera work as always, and thank you to our lovely ladies in Final Control, to Kirsty and Chelsea and Lou. Most importantly, a very, very big thank you to all of you watching across the world. I hope you've had a fantastic experience and a wonderful day, and we will catch you tomorrow. Bye-bye, everybody.